All right, you ready to go? We're ready to go. All right, we'll call today's meeting to order. This is the March 9th, 2021 meeting of the Standing Policy Committee on Water and Waste, Riverbank Management and the Environment. Bit confusing as we're also meeting as the Appeals Committee. This is our rotation, but this is the regular meeting of the Standing Committee. We meet today on Treaty One Land, the traditional homeland of the Métis Nation. My name is Brian Mays. I'm the City Councillor for St. Vital Ward. I'll be chairing today's meeting, joined in the chamber here by my colleague Councillor Nason and virtually by Councillors Orlico and Councillor Schreier. We also have Moira Gear, our director here, as well as staff from City Clerks and from the Water and Waste Utility. No Jeff Patton. It's a new era here, but we have Tim and Mr. Gordachuk here to help us out. So appreciate that. We have to, Madam Clerk, first up the appeal or first up the minutes. If Councillor Nason could move the minutes for our last meeting. So John and Jason, vote on the approval of the minutes of the last meeting. All those in favor, that's carried. Then on to appeal hearing, Madam Clerk. Okay. So I know it's very unusual for us to have this many delegations at Water and Waste. So unfortunately, it's also the one day we have an appeal hearing. So we got to wait on the delegations, but that's democracy. So away we go then with our appeal hearing.
Okay. The process the committee will follow is the appellant will be heard first, followed by those in support of the appeal. Next, those registered in opposition are heard, followed by those registered for information. Finally, the appellant may return to speak in rebuttal to comments made. However, no new information is permitted. Please note that when your name is called, it is your opportunity to speak. However, you are not obligated to do so. Item one is an appeal under the City of Winnipeg Sewer Bylaw number 106 of 2018 at 90 Eastgate. All participants have been muted and will only be permitted to speak when called upon. Once you have been heard, you can either remain in the Zoom meeting or leave and continue to watch live via the city's YouTube channel. If any participants are currently watching the meeting live on YouTube, please mute your audio player now. So if the public service would like to give a brief overview, or we can go right into the appellant.
Maybe just go straight to the appellant.
Okay.
Please.
Okay.
That's so okay, Mr. Chair.
The appellant is Daniel Fontaine. He's with us via Zoom today. Daniel, we'll just need you to unmute so that we can hear you. Hi, Daniel. Can you hear us?
Yes, I can hear.
All right, you have up to 10 minutes for your presentation, beginning now.
Okay, well, I guess it's pretty simple, my argument here. It's just like we requested a private sewer service repair, and we're denied based on the fact that they didn't think that we were a single family dwelling. And I don't think that's true based on the definition. Like it says, a multiple family dwelling is where there's more than one dwelling unit, which I understand to mean like kitchen, cooking facilities, living room, dining room, which we only have one of those. And you know, if there are a couple families living in the house, I don't think that changes the fact that it's a single family dwelling and it's owner occupied. And then like, I don't really have the finances currently to be able to do, like I already hired someone to replace a section of the line, but I don't have what's needed to do the rest out to the road. And, so then it puts me in a place where I have to live in this with sewer backing up somewhat frequently. So that's where I'm just asking for help here. And the denial doesn't really make sense to me as far as the definition of the law.
Can you, it's Brian Mays here, Daniel. Could you clarify who's living there? What's the arrangement? How many people?
Well, I and my family live there along with two other families currently, kind of a group community type setting, but those families sometimes change and someone else will come in, but we all live together. We share the same kitchen. In essence, we're one family. We've gone through with zoning and they've deemed us as one family. It's a single family residence.
Do you have any evidence? Have you filed anything in support of that statement that zoning has deemed you to be in a single family home?
No, the only thing I filed was the letter that I wrote to the Water and Waste Department, which did mention the zoning bylaw.
Okay, but are you saying that's your interpretation of the zoning bylaw and therefore you feel zoning deems you to be a single family dwelling? Or are you saying there has been some hearing, some process whereby the city's zoning staff have deemed you to be in a single family setting?
No, there's been nothing. No official case like that.
Okay. And so roughly 12 people in the house living there, or?
Yes.
Okay. If that's your presentation, Mr. Fontaine, then I'll see if there are any questions from Councilor Schreier has a question, and we'll go to the other councillors after that, if necessary. Go ahead, Councillor Schreier.
Thank you, Councillor Mays. Mr. Fontaine, you mentioned that the city judges this on whether there's more than one family. When I do look on the first page of the appeal, section 41, subsection 5, subsection B is quoted. So it says the obligation of the director to act under subsection 1 only applies to single family dwellings that are only owner occupied, and B, two family dwellings where at least one dwelling unit is owner occupied. Are you aware of that, sir? Because you said if it's more than one family, here it says it mentions two family dwellings, a dwelling for two families.
I was aware of that. I guess it's not really clear to me how that bylaw fits my application.
Okay.
Because in my opinion, it's a single family dwelling. We are a single family, deeming that we cook and eat our meals together and use the same living and dining areas.
But the other people may change?
Occasionally, yes.
But it is a commercial relationship as well, sir, in that there's some sort of contract or
no
official point of paying rent?
No, there's no commercial relationship. It's strictly opening our home for other people to be able to use with us.
Just so you know, sir, in my opinion anyway, for me it's sort of hard to work with that in terms of making a decision, but nonetheless, thank you for explaining yourself. And one more question, sorry, Councilor Mays.
Yeah.
You had said that it's zoned. How is it zoned to you, multifamily, single family? What did you say?
It's a single family dwelling as far as zoning goes.
Okay. And Councillor Mays made the point you have no documentation on that other than
that's correct.
Right. Which doesn't mean you're wrong. I mean, but nonetheless, thank you. Thank you, Councillor Mays.
Thank you. Any Councillor Nathan has a question?
Yeah, thank you. I, along with Councillor Schreier, just trying to get an understanding. Now you indicate, is it accurate that you said 12 people maximum reside in this home?
Yes.
Okay. But is that three congregate family units?
Yeah, I guess you could say that. I mean, you know, we're tied together based on religious convictions. We're the same Bible believing group. So that's kind of where our staying in the same house comes from. So that's, you know, I don't know what else to say besides that.
Okay. That's a good understanding. Give me a little more context. Have you explored changing the zoning on your property from residential one, R1L? I'm not sure what that translates, and I'll ask the public service after, to something more appropriate for multi-family living?
Well, no, I have not explored that. Like, in my understanding, multi-family living, as far as zoning goes, means that you have separate living facilities that may be connected to a common area, but that are completely separate, with separate kitchens and laundry facilities or whatnot. So I haven't explored that, but that doesn't really fit our application.
Okay, that's all I have this one.
And there's a requirement for that it be owner occupied. So are you one of the owners, Mr. Fontaine, or are you the sole owner, or what's the ownership situation there?
I am one of the owners, yes.
Okay, thank you. Councillor Orlico?
So how many owners are there? Is it part of the church is the owner, or is it you as a member of the church is the owner, or are you a direct owner?
I'm a direct owner along with one other person.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. And Madam Clerk, anyone else registered on the appeal?
We have no one else registered in support of the appeal. We have no one registered in opposition to the appeal, and we have no one registered for information for the appeal.
So, our usual stirring question to the gallery can be skipped, because there's nobody in the gallery and COVID. So over to the administration then. For the administration's position here on why the original denial, and I assume why the appeal should be denied in the eyes of it.
I will ask Tim to speak to the appeal, please.
As an overview, right? Okay, so we're talking about the property at 90 Eastgate. It's had some issues with its private sewer service. There's been some repair done already on the property. There's been a request to assess the rest of the sewer service. Just as a refresher here, the bylaw, as a refresher, a property owner owns the sewer pipe in its entirety, right? Like right from the toilet, right out to the sewer main that's underneath the street. And because of that, when a repair is required underneath the street, you know, it can be deeper, it's under pavement, it's more expensive. And so the sewer bylaw has a provision for financial assistance under certain conditions to help people with that expense. The current qualifications for that assistance are that, you know, the property has to be single family property, owner occupied. It can be a duplex, it can be a two dwelling property if the owner occupies one of those things. It has to be owner occupied exclusively. And the idea behind that is to target the financial assistance to you know, people with less resources, sort of thing. The property in question here, you know, it's a very large property. Yes, you know, there's 20 rooms, 5 bathrooms, this kind of thing.
To project a little.
Sorry, it's a large property, and in our discussions with various, there was contact with the department in January, late December and in January, on the basis of you know, asking for utility locates for their private repair, and on the basis of you know, information gathered during those interactions, you know, the department's determination is that there's a, you know, a large number of people living here. And, you know, it's been referred to as a community house or a school. There's some schooling going on there. It's on the province's website as a homeschool location. So the complicated nature of the use of the property doesn't fall into the category or the spirit of the intent of the sewer bylaw to provide assistance to owner-occupied single-family dwellings. I will note too that the zoning bylaw does have clauses, you know, to define single-family dwellings. It also has a clause that specifies when in conflict with another bylaw, the more restrictive conditions apply. Right? So, yeah, it's the department's determination that this wouldn't qualify.
Okay, so we're the department's view is this is not a single-family dwelling in that there are multiple families in the dwelling.
Yes.
Yeah, okay.
Yes.
Well, relatively straightforward here, colleagues, at least in terms of the legal positions. Any questions for the administration arising out of that? Councillor Orlico.
Yeah, thank you very much. And thank you also for this program. It has really helped some of my residents out in the past. Can you tell me on that program, is it fully subscribed every year, or is there access available at the end of the year? How is that program doing?
I don't have that information on hand. I'm not sure. Is Dave Shaw on Zoom? If Dave's available, he might be able to comment.
David has not joined us via Zoom today.
Okay. We'll have to provide that information.
We can get back to you, Councillor. We have a budget that we set each year that's part of the council approved budget. And I think maybe we budget $500,000 a year for these repairs for single family dwellings. That is fully subscribed typically. But we can get back.
But typically it's fully subscribed. And some years oversubscribed, because I know, and then my point is, I know people who are in single family houses have been denied because it's been over, there's just no money left. So I just want to confirm that. Well, I got the phone call, so pretty sure it's true.
Yeah, no, it's.
If there's nothing else from Councillor Orlico, Councillor Schreier has his hand up. Councillor Schreier.
Thank you, Chair Mays. Yeah, just on this, it sounds like a popular program, and no surprise to that. And I'm just curious, you know, Councillor Orlico made the point, sounds like it gets fully subscribed. I probably get the impression regularly since it started. How long have we had this program? It's not too much of a tangent, sorry, Councillor Mays.
The program is budgeted annually. It's in the operating budget. It comes out of the operating funds. And then the program is intended for single family dwellings. So there's a number of properties that have the same issue that don't qualify for funding under the sewer bylaw provisions. That was a council policy decision to make it single family dwelling.
How often, what is the average?
I'm just trying to find those. The cost is varies, Councillor, depending upon the nature of the repair, the size of the property, etc., where the break occurs. So that is dependent upon each situation. Yeah. And there is the city does have a list of qualified contractors that property owners can use for repair. I'm just going to see if I can find out the annual budget amount.
And when was this brought in again? Sorry.
1984. 1984.
Oh, 1984. Yeah.
1984.
Applied to all properties. It at one point it did apply to all properties, but that was a decision to limit it to single family. So,
all right. Again, we're not in a narrow legal sense. We're just deciding whether the appeal falls within the program, not so much it. Albeit interesting history or description. That said, you have a right to appeal for a reason. So you can base your judgment on what you think fit. So Councillor Nason, I think had a question.
I know Councillor Orlico will have a snicker when I say I didn't vote for the operating budget, but my question to the public service specific to single family dwellings. Given the unique living arrangement that was explained by the appellant, do you see this as qualifying as a single family dwelling?
No, that's why we denied.
Just wanted to be explicit on that.
That's why we were, the intent of the bylaw and the definitions in the bylaw and the use of the property is not consistent with our interpretation of what's in the bylaw.
Thank you.
How did we know this? I mean, you could have 11 children and have an immense, you could have a lot of water usage. I would assume the 12 people living there, should there be 12 people living there, use rather more water than if four people were living there. But are we,
how was it determined?
Yeah, did we, maybe that's not legally relevant either, but I'm just wondering how it's an odd case, I gotta say.
I think, you know what, when these things happen, we have significant interaction with the property owners. Okay. So I think a lot of the use of the property, a lot of it was determined by the department working with the property owners.
So honesty wasn't the best policy?
Well.
And I you know.
There's always it could always be appealed to the court. Could probably file with the ombudsman. I mean, God knows we have to deal with the ombudsman over just denying somebody's water bill. That, I mean, if we decide today to deny the appeal and for faith-based reasons, the appellant says my definition of family should be accepted. Well, there are other avenues to pursue. I mean, it's an interesting.
Is that legal?
Interesting. Yeah, no, it's an interesting. How does one define the term family in a non-discriminatory fashion? I mean, otherwise you run the risk of virtually anything qualifying as single families. Run your apartment building, but you claim you're all, you know,
congregate,
the same entrance, so therefore it's all congregate.
Is there a question?
Yeah, that's foray into law school there. So moving on, any further questions? If not, we have back to
the appellant
for right of rebuttal.
Yes, the appellant is entitled to speak in rebuttal to comments made. However, no new information is permitted. So Daniel, if there's anything you'd like to say in rebuttal to the comments you heard today, you can go ahead. Daniel?
Yes, I'm here. I don't really know what else to say. I've kind of done my best effort at trying to get something to work for everyone here, but I guess thanks for hearing me.
Thank you. Anything arising into that, colleagues? Any questions? If not, thank you, Mr. Fontaine, and journalists in my 9 years here, I haven't seen one like this, so it's an interesting case to look at. So if there's no other questions for admin or questions for Mr. Fontaine, I guess it's time for someone to move a motion then, Madam Clerk. Councilor Nason seems ready, willing, and able. Thank you for that.
Yep.
Fire away, Councilor Nason.
I'll move that the receipt of the public representations be concluded.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. That's carried.
I'll move that the appeal be denied and that the decision of the customer technical services supervisor, engineering division, water and waste department be confirmed. or is it canceled?
No, so if you'd like to move a motion to deny the appeal, then yes, you're confirming the decision dated January 16th for the premises located at 90 Eastgate.
Correct. Thank you.
And can we get supporting comments you'd like to?
It doesn't say that for this one.
That's fair enough too. I will be in favor of that motion. I do think the decision, the definition of family does seem to exclude the living arrangement, whatever Mr. Fontaine and his the other people in the house have chosen to do. Should they feel that definition of family is breaches the Constitution or the Human Rights Code, it's in their court to court's the wrong term. It's in their bailiwick to proceed through some other forum. But for today, I agree with Councillor Nason.
Yeah, I know Councillor Schreier.
Sorry, Jason. Did you have further comments? Fire away. Yes.
Yeah. Thanks, Brian. I agree with Councillor May's comments on this and Councillor Nason's motion. There's sympathy in terms of what the definition of family is. Certainly, we don't all share the precise definition of family in terms of how people live together, their concepts of partnerships and family. And I think that's always been the case in human nature, but we create human constructs as well. And it can change over time. And we tend to make our decisions based on the mores and perceptions of the era. And a couple of things on that, as Councillor May says, that, this can be taken to court. Perhaps these issues should be. It's just difficult for us as city councillors to make decisions that sort of challenge what could be constitutional issues or greater legal issues. And so I certainly do have sympathy on this one, but I have to go with the city's intent as the administration perceives the intent of the bylaws, and that seems pretty clear to me. And given the nature of the house as well, this house is meant for many people to live in it traditionally. And we used to have larger families back 100 years ago, and this would be the kind of house that would have had more people living in it. And having said that, I'd say that the bylaws that is interpreted by the administration and their judgment stance, I support the motion by Councillor Nason, but I do sympathize with all people in terms of looking at how they may wish to have our society and our courts reanalyze the definition of what family means to them at any point in our society. Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Nason. I think that.
Yeah,
to clarify.
Just from a perspective, but understanding that it's a hearing, and I know the clerks have cautioned us in the past with regards to our comments to be clear, concise, short. And I know this one didn't offer a position for supporting comments. However, my only comment would be that I believe when you have a congregate living situation, that the zoning should be reflected of it. It's not, from my understanding of single family, even if it was a secondary suite, this goes beyond a two-unit living arrangement. This is multiple families living in the area. So that is the reason why I'm not supportive of this appeal.
Okay, so
question.
Thank you. We'll call the question. All those in favor of Councillor Nason's motion to deny the appeal? Aye. All right, that's carried.
Okay.
And
the last is that the appeal hearing be concluded.
All right. All those in favor of concluding? Aye. Thank you. That's passed. Back over to you, Madam Clerk.
All right. So next we have delegations.
Do you not have closing?
Not for a regulatory one? Appeal hearing.
Okay.
No, but thank you.
Great. I'm learning still.
No, we have many different appeals. Okay. On to delegations, and have some here at Water and Waste, which is a rarity. All right, so we'll fire away.
Okay. So all of our delegations today are to be heard with respect to report 4, use of natural gas in the city of Winnipeg. And the first delegate we have is Ken Clausen. Ken's joining us via Zoom today.
Ken, we haven't seen you here for a while, Ken. Have you back?
I've been laying low.
Ken.
I apologize first for the background noise. I'm having new basement windows installed, and there's a worker behind me. and counselors, you'll be glad to know that they're very energy efficient, made in Winnipeg, tri-pane windows. What I want to do this morning is I want to speak in favor of the motion. However, importantly, I want to recommend some amendments. I'll briefly introduce myself for those of you on the committee who don't know who I am. And I want to also provide some context and background about why I support a transition away from natural gas. In terms of introducing myself, I have almost four decades of experience promoting sustainable building practices and more sustainable communities. This includes more than two decades of experience in the public sector developing energy climate change policies and programs. I have almost another two decades of international work as a private consultant. So it gives me good insight into what's going on elsewhere in the world where I work in Europe, Middle East, United States, and Asia. I am a former member, a recovering member, of the City of Winnipeg Civic Environmental Committee who drafted the City of Winnipeg's first sustainability strategy. So I think you'll find that I provide hopefully a unique perspective to this issue. There is really no path forward to meeting our civic, provincial, or national obligations to decarbonize our economy without a rapid transition away from natural gas. This motion that's before you this morning is positioned as an economic imperative. However, improving the energy performance of new and existing private and public buildings has compelling and economic benefits. It will reduce the almost $200 million that we spend each year to import non-renewable natural gas from Alberta. It will create well-paying local jobs and support local businesses, and cost-effective retrofits and conversions to ground source heat pumps will increase not only local disposable income, it'll also reduce the City of Winnipeg's expenditures and taxes. The motion before you, I have a concern that it provides no context about what other jurisdictions are doing to accelerate the transition in new and existing buildings away from natural gas. In July of 2019, Berkeley, California became the first city in North America to pass a motion to ban natural gas. Notable is that the vote from Berkeley City Council was unanimous, and more importantly, was publicly supported by Pacific Gas and Electric, which is the second largest energy utility in the United States. Strong measures such as was passed in Berkeley usually attack fierce opposition, and this motion before you will attract opposition, I can guarantee you. However, Berkeley City Council member spearheaded a six-month outreach program that was so persuasive, not a single person spoke at the hearing opposing the proposed ban. So take that lesson. I note with concern that the motion before the committee today also lacks an outreach program to inform and build public support. So that might be something you may want to add to your motion. Since Berkeley's ban, more than 50 other cities across California and elsewhere in the United States have taken action to encourage all electric new construction and to transition away from natural gas. So this isn't a one-off thing. The movement to end natural gas and new construction is not limited to California, nor is it limited to the United States. The United Kingdom has adopted a ban on using natural gas for home heating. Originally scheduled for 2025, they've moved it up to 2023, just 2 years from now. In terms of other amendments, if I look at a timeline for halting the further expansion of natural gas infrastructure, I would encourage you to insert the word a strategy in timeline, because that's what we really want. And I think the word of, you know, talking about bans and so on is kind of a little bit inflammatory. I think what you want to talk about is, rather than immediate bans, is you want to talk about an accelerated transition or a rapid transition away from natural gas. I think that that's a more positive tone to the motion. It will likely be easier to gain the support of your fellow council members when this goes to full council. The other concern I have is on meaningful public consultation. The period that set out in the motion, I'm just scrolling through the motion, was too short. I think the period was, 90 days? Yep. 3 months. And you know, the city of Winnipeg, to its credit, is doing a better job with public consultations with some notable failures, but you are doing a better job in public consultations. And I can guarantee you, based on my 40 years of experience, what you're asking for cannot be done in 90 days. You'll get a plan and you'll get recommendations, but it will not be a meaningful public consultation. So I really worry about the burden that you're putting. And I think that, you know, 120 days would be much more realistic. So I'd also recommend that amendment. And lastly, the final element of the motion in F talks about consulting local experts, which I think is a great idea. However, after the word, consulting, it's item number two, not F, pardon me. It talks about in item number two about consult with local experts, including, and lists the number of organizations, which is all good choices. However, after the word local expert, I would insert the word and stakeholders. And the stakeholders that I would add would include Efficiency Manitoba, which is responsible for demand side management in this province and has a budget of more than $250 million in the next 3 years that can be directed towards, some of which could be directed towards this effort. Manitoba Hydro, obviously, because they're the energy and gas supplier. And the Manitoba Home Builders Association is, with some hesitancy, that I recommend that you contact Manitoba Hydro and MHBA. I can tell you from my experience in working with both organizations is that there are many good and progressive people within those organizations. Well, those organizations in the past have often been barriers to progress. And a good example of that is the recent report on Manitoba Hydro and their demand side management efforts, which everyone from not just me, but the Public Utility Board and the recent report prepared for the provincial government cited that Manitoba Hydro is often too cautious and too conservative. So, you know, I think to have credibility that you have to be explicit in directing the administration. You're not limiting the consultation to these parties, but I think strategically not naming them in the motion, Hydro, Efficiency Manitoba, and MHBA, who are, you know, greatly affected by this motion, I think it'll come across as the motion is being too slanted. So that's my comments and that's my recommendations. I welcome any questions.
Thank you, Mr. Klassen. Councillor Schreier has some questions, has a question.
Thank you, Councillor Mays. I do. And thank you, Mr. Klassen. Thank you so much for your consideration on this, your time, your expertise being put into this. The fact that you take it this seriously to give it what I consider some very positive, very constructive criticism to make this what I believe sincerely, truly, a better document, a better motion. Thank you very much. A couple of questions. When I was raising this on the council floor, and I believe as Councillor Mays, I think has pointed out, I the information that I gave, I think that led to Councillor Mays's sort of reconsideration of this was just what I said on the council chamber, essentially nothing else. And what we're seeing is democracy alive in action. This meeting today, right in front of the public. I haven't talked with you about this, Mr. Klassen, but you're certainly having influence on how I'm perceiving it just from what you just said just now. Given previous council meetings and, you know, Councillor Orlico thanked me one time for talking about how our 25-year plan for reducing on climate change doesn't include conversion away from natural gas. And that was 2-3 council meetings ago. Whether Councillor Orlico realized it or not, he did thank me officially on the council chamber floor. And so here we go with Councillor Mays's motion. And so just first of all, I really want to thank you. This is really important. And you mentioned California and Berkeley and moving away from natural gas. Mr. Klassen, did you realize that the electrical grid, if you were to convert from natural gas pipe setup to the electrical grid, do you realize that in California, 47% of their electricity from their electrical grid comes from natural gas?
Well, there's important similarities, but there's important differences between Manitoba and California. The first thing is that the transition away from natural gas makes way more sense in Manitoba than it does in Berkeley or elsewhere in California.
That's my point.
In California's target, they want to decarbonize their grid by 2045. That's in 24 years, they want to get to a zero carbon grid. We're there today. I looked at Manitoba Hydro's annual report yesterday. 99.9% of the electricity that was generated in Manitoba last year was from renewable sources, about 3% from wind and the balance from hydroelectric. We have a 24-year leap ahead of California, who has a bigger economy than Canada, you know, 40 million people. And the sense that I get is we are squandering an economic opportunity. There are others here this morning who will talk about the environmental imperative. I've devoted the last 20 years of my career to supporting Canadian companies that are exporting energy efficient and sustainable building products and services abroad. When I get off the plane at Winnipeg Airport, I just want to scream at you people of the opportunities that are being squandered. The world is making a fundamental transition away from fossil fuels. And, you know, a third of the jobs in this province depend on exports. And, you know, we can either choose to be a leader or a laggard. And that's what this motion does today. If you don't want to support it, you know, fine. You know, if you're happy being a laggard, good for you. But I want to be a leader. I don't want to be a laggard.
Couldn't have said any better myself, Mr. Klassen. Thanks so much. Thank you, Councillor. Thank you, Councillor Mays.
I think Councillor Orlico is next, I think.
Yeah, please. I'm Mr. Klassen. Thanks, long time no see. Real kind of, with the expertise, it's a quick question. When we're looking at converting from, let's say, natural gas to renewable energy source, should we be saying natural gas or fossil fuels?
Well, in Manitoba, well, the statistics often aren't broken off at a city level, but I know in Manitoba, last time I looked at the stats, that the number of people who use propane and fuel oil in Manitoba are very few. There's 267,000 residential accounts for natural gas. There's probably less than 10,000 fuel oil people left in the whole province, and most of those in rural areas. There's probably only a handful in Winnipeg. Propane is used, particularly in the north. There is virtually no propane being used, you know, in most buildings in Manitoba. The strategy you have to come up with needs to be a little bit more nuanced. You know, there's the economics of doing a transition away from natural gas is very different in new construction. It's much more attractive in new construction than it is in a retrofit. There are certain areas where you may not be able to ban natural gas. Berkeley has had one area of opposition, and that's restaurants, that it's very difficult to prepare a lot of foods and high volumes and so on in a restaurant without access to natural gas. So, you know, there's some subtleties, and that's why I'm saying is that if this looks too rushed and you're trying to do all of this in 90 days, the administration is not going to be able to do that. You're going to get unnecessary pushback.
I agree. Well, just one follow-up question. So I do agree with you. I fully support the idea of moving away from natural gas, but we got to do this right. And it isn't, as you say, nuanced, not that simplistic, but again, we have to move. So we have to do both. We have to walk and chew gum at the same time. So I agree. So are you suggesting that in, you know, 120 days that the administration would come back with a strategy and timelines to implement decrease, a reduction or elimination of natural gas use in Winnipeg?
Well,
I gas for heating use. I'm not sure. That's what I mean.
Yeah. Well, the dominant use of natural gas in Winnipeg is for space heating. I mean, there are some industrial uses. Natural gas is used in great quantities elsewhere in Manitoba to produce fertilizer, for example, in Brandon. I would like to point out that we are already in the midst of a transition away from natural gas in this city, and you may not realize that. I would challenge you, when you go through the 99 Parade of Homes, count the number of electric water heaters you see versus natural gas. You'll find that virtually in the last several years, that virtually all new homes in Manitoba have already made a transition away from natural gas to electric water heaters for a variety of reasons. Councillor Orlico, you've seen my house. You know where I live. My house was built in 1941. It was heated with coal. Shortly after the Second World War, it was converted to oil. When I bought the house, it had been converted to a standard efficiency natural gas furnace. I converted it to a mid-efficiency furnace and more recently to a high-efficiency furnace. My house has gone through three transitions between fuels. We've done this before, councillors.
And I should note the administration, who have been remarkably cooperative on this, have said they want 180 days, and that's, which would push us to September, I think. And for me, that's fine. It's I think that's probably okay with other committee members, but thank you for that. Just wanted to be clear on the time frame there. Councillor Nason, and then back to Councillor Schreier.
I'm the new kid on the block, Mr. Klassen, so I don't have the background on you or past history. But I do have history of growing up in a region where dependence on electric heating is a very costly one, even though New Brunswick, where I grew up, had a nuclear power plant. It continues to be extremely high to heat homes. More recently, people have moved to heat pumps to utilize to reduce the cost, because baseboard heats was the general approach that was used if you moved away from oil heating of your home. Hearing California, Berkeley, and PCG, who has its own host of problems with regards to maintenance of their electrical grid, multiple lawsuits over recent tragic fires out there. Manitoba Hydro and the challenges that they've indicated, at least first blush, with moving away. I know Councillor Schreier has talked regularly about construction inflation. I figured I'd get that shot in about construction inflation. But, you know, yes, I understand moving away from hot water tanks from gas to electric. I had a house in River Heights that had a gas hot water tank. Loved the immediacy of on demand of hot water from gas. The electric tank in my house that I have now is a 60 liter tank. So I've got more than enough for my family's needs. Sometimes I'd like to restrict it so the showers are shorter. But I guess the question I would have is, we've gone down the pike of green. Why is it that, you know, and I'm sure that northern communities would argue that Manitoba Hydro is not green. So from a perspective of ultimate green approaches to heating homes, what is the ultimate green energy, in your opinion?
Well, the ultimate green energy is energy efficiency, and that's what this motion speaks to. That we merely don't want to transition away from natural gas, but what we want to do at the same time is we want to employ all of the cost-effective opportunities to lower the cost to operate our buildings. This is, energy efficiency is better than a free lunch. It's a lunch you're paid to eat. It is not, we don't talk about energy efficiency being so many dollars per ton of carbon emission reductions, because if it's cost-effective, it's saving more than it costs. I challenge the notion that electric heating costs more. There's two different forms of heat pumps. There's air source heat pumps and ground source heat pumps. If you look at Manitoba Hydro's, their own information, the lowest cost of heating a new home in Manitoba is not natural gas. It's a ground source heat pump. Mm-hmm. Manitoba Hydro has for more than 20 years published a comparison of annual heating costs for a typical home. And they use extremely conservative figures for ground source heat pumps, a COP of 2.5. Even using those very pessimistic figures about ground source heat pumps, it's still the cheapest source of energy. I did the numbers. Average house in the Parade of Homes is running between $300,000 and $400,000 plus the cost of a lot. So it's about $500,000. The cost difference for a ground source heat pump for these homes will be mostly not the cost of the equipment in the house. It'll be mostly the loop. It's about an extra maybe 20, 25 grand. At today's interest rates, it's about $1,000 a year. It's less. It's about $80, $85 a month. Okay. And you save on the energy and you have a house that's more affordable. Natural gas right now is near record low prices. I looked at forecasts from the International Energy Agency, the U.S. Energy Information Administration, and Canada's regulatory agency. Every one of them predicts significantly higher natural gas prices over the next 10 years. Mm-hmm. So we have among the lowest our electricity prices in North America. We have a cold climate where we need a lot of heating. And we have the expertise to install ground source heat pumps. And Manitoba Hydro themselves admit that ground source heat pumps are the lowest cost of energy. And if a third of the buildings in this province are already heated with electricity, if we go and retrofit them, there's a tremendous amount of electricity that we can free up that can be used to serve new loads. And the Manitoba Hydro, there's a reason both at first as an employee and then as a consultant, wrote plans of how to strip Manitoba Hydro of the responsibility for demand side management, because there was an NDP government, there's a public utility board, and the current conservative government all agree the Manitoba Hydro is very short-sighted, and that's why we have Efficiency Manitoba, a separate standalone agency which has stripped Hydro of all the responsibilities.
Starting to move a bit afield from, the motion doesn't say all in for Hydro. The motion says, look at alternatives. So it could be geothermal. I metaphorically feel Rob Altmaier tapping me on the shoulder to say it's not just Hydro, it could be geothermal. So the motion envisages that it doesn't have to be a conversion to Hydro. So, but it's the motion also envisages, yes, how do we move away from natural gas? But it also, yes, that what is the cost? And yeah, obviously there's a target in the climate change plan, but what is the financial cost of action, or what is the financial cost of inaction? Councillor Nason, anything more? It is interesting. It's interesting where one grows up in this country. You have a very different conception of how heating works. It is interesting. Councillor Schreier, who grew up in many places, Ottawa and Winnipeg among them. So.
Primarily as in my childhood and youth, yeah, Winnipeg and Ottawa, Winnipeg, Ottawa. Happened to be when depends on how you grow up. I was raised on Hydro. I consider Hydro my big brother. Kind of like Folklorama or Autopack kind of thing. It's just one of those things I was raised on. My dad was kind of growing them, literally doubling the Hydro capacity, and I was sort of raised on that. So, you know, when we have a climate action plan for 25 years for the city that doesn't include converting to Hydro or other forms, you know, don't be surprised that I noticed kind of thing. And thank you, Councillor Mays, for noticing that, because this is really, really important. I'm going to go out on a limb right now, Councillor Mays, given what Councillor Orlico has already said in terms of his perceptions of what should be happening with this motion. And Councillor Mays, I'm going to ask that you consider at this point just what you started with this motion, the gravity of this democracy in action, both on the council floor that started your motion and what's happening now. And Councillor Mays, as we continue on these delegations and today, that you consider holding off on your motion and reintroducing it at the next meeting, given what we're going to hear today, to make it a better motion. I ask that you give that some consideration, Councillor Mays, given just the gravity of what you've started here. And I'll leave it at that. Thank you.
Okay. Well, we do need three votes to get it through, so I will learn that lesson over time. So I know Councillor Orlico had some. I prefer to go forward. I prefer to go forward with heavy-duty amendments if needed. I'm fine with that. I would like to keep progressing here, but
that's cool. If you want to do that live on the floor here, I'm okay with it. It can get clunky and time consuming. That's my concern, because now we all have to do it now rather than, you know, have taking a month and
and doing it that way. But that's, I'm going to support you. I'm going to continue to support you on this, Councilor.
Well, at some point we'll get, I think Councilor Urquhart has some amendments. Perhaps we can read those out at some point and kick those around. And
yeah,
I think the 180 day business is, I think we have 3 or 4 votes for that at least. Okay. So if there are no further questions for Mr. Klassen, thank you. Thanks for your delegation. And Madam Clerk, on to the next.
Okay, the next delegation is Kurt Hall, Project Director, Climate Change Connection. Kurt has provided supporting documentation and it's been republished in the agenda under item 4. Hi, Kurt. You're now live with the standing committee. You have up to 10 minutes for your presentation.
We won't say long time no see to you, Kurt, because we have seen you here recently. So welcome back. And yeah, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much, Councillor Mays. And it's good to see the other councillors that I know and have may not have seen for a while. And it's good to meet your acquaintance, Councillor Nason. So first of all, I just want to say that I really appreciate this motion and I'm here to speak in support of it. Climate Change Connection supports this motion completely. And my submission today and my presentation is not going to be technical. I'll leave that to Ken Klassen and Dudley Thompson and others to talk about the technicalities of how it is that we can do this and the mechanisms of it. Instead, my presentation here is to remind us all as to why this is important. And I would say that it's fundamentally important and profoundly important. We have a duty, in fact, I don't think I'm overstating this. I believe we have a duty to move in this direction and to pass this motion. Because I think if you look around, you can realize that climate change is getting worse every year. And there's indications that the rate of global heating is accelerating. I mean, it was 12 degrees yesterday. It was March 8th, and it was 12 degrees here in Winnipeg yesterday. That's not by accident, and that's not normal. And this is what's happening and progressing into the future. And if we take our responsibility to the coming generation seriously, we must consider this motion very seriously. So I think besides the primary consequences of climate change, severe weather, floods and droughts, et cetera, there are the secondary consequences of climate change, which are primarily economic. And those are coming our way as well. So whereas we may experience sort of discomfort here from climate change, if you will, and increasing costs, there are other parts of the world that are literally going to be, their food systems are going to collapse and climate migrants and refugees are going to start happening more and more often, climate conflicts, and those are going to have a consequence on our economy here in Winnipeg. So there's an economic consequence as well as protecting us from the environmental consequences. But what I'm going to walk you through here are just a couple of important facts that you need to keep in mind. And that's in my submission there. And I'll draw your attention to the two figures on page 2 of my submission. And I can share my screen here. And so you'll see this, what you should see are the two figures. So these figures come from a report from the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, IPCC. They released this, what was a seminal document in Thanksgiving in 2018. And it talks about the future global heating and what needs to be done in order to bring it under control, if you will. So what it says in that first graph that you see is the average annual global temperature trajectory. The red line on the left side of the graph is historical, and this is what we're experiencing now. But you can see that it's virtually linear. It's headed into the future in a straight line with the current rate of greenhouse gas emissions that we're pumping into the atmosphere. And you don't have to go too many decades into the future until you see that it's above 2 degrees Celsius. And when you get into that area, we're talking about potentially runaway climate change, when you get runaway melting of Greenland and of the permafrost, et cetera, creating methane, et cetera. So that's what we want to prevent. We want to bend that curve. And that's what brings us to, okay, how do we do that? And that's what brings us to the second curve. And this is the one that's really starkly important and disturbing, because what it talks about is a dramatic reduction in our greenhouse gas emissions in the next few decades. That I've put some red lines on the graph that aren't in the report itself, but you've got 2020, basically where we are now, 2030 and 2050. And you can see that this scenario, in order to flatten the curve, in order to bring climate change under control, we have to reduce greenhouse gas emissions in on that order of magnitude. So basically cut it in half by the end of the decade, and then bring it to zero by 2050. So what this means is that this is where the future lies. If we're going to have a future that's successful for our children, we need to bring this curve down. And so that means that the future does not include natural gas for heating. It must not. And the longer it takes before we realize that and bring about that shift, the more chaotic the shift becomes. Because you can see that if we get to a point where the global heating gets too profound and the consequences become too profound, the consequences on our economy may make it impossible for us to make that transition comfortably, put it that way. So I'll also draw your attention on the third page to the Road to Resilience, which is a document that we published a few weeks ago, and there's a link in there to the document, and it talks about, it provides a frame for the transition that we're talking about for all of the primary sectors. So we're talking about the things that we need to do in the immediate future. We need to be able to feed ourselves locally without fossil fuel fertilizers and without diesel for machinery. We need to be able to heat all of our buildings old and new affordably without natural gas. We need to be able to move all goods and people without gasoline or diesel. And we must develop and use our electricity resource effectively, efficiently, and affordably in order to meet those other three objectives. And of those objectives, buildings is actually the toughest one. And as been rightly said, we can't just switch fuels. We have to look at efficiency, and we have to look at things like the heat pumps, and that Mr. Clausen suggested, and et cetera. So I'm just putting it forward to you that even though this challenge is difficult, it's imperative, and we have to take it on. And I'm very, very appreciative of the leadership that you're showing here by bringing this motion forward. And I'll conclude just by saying that I fully support it, and thank you for bringing it forward.
Thank you, Kurt. I'll have a comment later, but Councillor Schreier is got a question.
Thank you for those watching. Just bear in mind, there are not two Kurt Hulls here. Kurt Hull's wearing the dark shirt with the light jacket, the dark jacket. But I wish I could be your twin on how you explained that. I was raised essentially, Kurt, just so you know, on what you're talking about, and very similar to how you're explaining it. And thank you so much for being here today, for your insights, to impart this to us and to everybody for the record of what is going to be possibly the most influential motion that we're going to pass here at City Hall in terms of affecting our environment right here, right now. It's got to start somewhere. And I can't think of anything the city's doing that is going to influence our environment and the economics of our environment as well, if you will, than this motion, just by virtue of the city of Winnipeg being so huge in proportion to our the population of this province and how it affects things. Kurt, you know, you're talking, when you show a graph, you know, your y-axis goes by 0.5 degrees. And people go, well, you know, it looks like that's such an angle because he's going by 0.5 degrees. Well, yeah, of course he could go by 0.2 degrees and it could look like it's like a steep ladder. But I guess Kurt, well, I guess for the record, could you explain how it is the difference that 2 degrees make? I mean, you know, my understanding is 2 degrees colder in 2-3 degrees is what creates an ice age. And yeah. I know that sounds unbelievable, but that's what research shows. 2 to 3 degrees, that creates the ice age. Could you explain the relevance of your graph in that respect?
Yeah. Yeah, it's actually, Councillor Schreider, it's 5 degrees is the difference between the current temperatures and about, it's actually about 4 at the beginning of the industrial revolution. Now we're about 5 degrees away, like, because we've added about 1.2 degrees since the beginning of industrialization.
Right. Well, I mean is that historically it would have been just 2-3 degrees, but yes, that's where we are now by virtue of heating the earth. Yeah. Thanks.
And you're talking about like half a degree. And actually, if you were to go to that that report, I summarized a portion of it. The other portion of it actually talks about the difference in consequence to the planet of 1.5 degrees of warming versus 2 degrees of warming. That one half degree that you were talking about. And within the report, it itemizes and quantifies the relative risk and consequences just in that one half degree of warming. And so it shows for the first time, actually, conclusively and scientifically substantiated by studies, that half a degree is really a profound difference. But yet, if you also look at that graph, if we continue on the linear projection, we're talking much more than half a degree by 2080 or 2070.
Thank you.
If there are no other questions, Kurt, I just want to thank you for the presentation. Councilor Nason, did you have a question? You do?
Yeah.
Okay, fire away. Sorry, my mistake.
I'll leave it for you to close eloquently as you usually do. Okay. And I'm going to use the term tarred, because I've been typically tarred as a conservative by many of my council colleagues.
With great effect.
Sure. But as a conservative, conservation of the environment is important. Be it hunting, fishing, looking out for the future of our families. I've got 2 young children. Decisions I make at City Hall, I want to make sure that, it's for future generations, learning Indigenous teachings as well. It's seven generations forward. Going to a zero emission balanced economy, is your perspective that the only use of oil would be for manufacturing purposes? Because obviously you're on components today that require oil in order for you to be able to communicate to us today. Is that something that you see as the future of oil?
Yeah, there are still some chemical usages of petroleum products that would still be necessary, but burning it and putting it into the atmosphere is my focus. That's what we need to stop.
Okay. So when the challenge I have, and this is a very deep conversation, and, when we talk about alternative energies and sources, and how we receive those, like we see the Teslas of the world and how they get the materials that they need in order to make the batteries, very ecologically unfriendly processes, to my knowledge. I know there's some more recent extraction methods that are being looked at, but how do we find the balance in a global economy? Like we're looking at moving, away from potentially from gas as our heat source. Where does that natural gas go if not for the, because it's an off product of oil exploration, right?
No, it's actually they drill for it specifically, and leaving it in the ground is the only option, and it's we need to stop drilling for all about petroleum products and gas products. And so your question, if I may, is related to the ecological and economic environmental consequences of all of the alternatives. And what I can say to you is this, is that it depends on where we put our focus. I mean, if we put constraints in the development of batteries and cars, or even if there's just a focus on it, alternatives will be arrived at. I mean, right now, the batteries you're talking about have rare earth metals and stuff like that, but there are research happening right now to look for alternatives. And that comes to where the focus is, and when there's concern about a particular element in the construction of something, alternatives can be found if we put our minds to it. And that's my take on it, rather than using that as a means to say, no, we have to stick with the status quo, because the status quo is absolutely not an option.
So my follow-up to that, and part of my review of this motion that Councillor Mays and Councillor Schreier have put forward, is looking at, you know, new developments as we continue to expand, or, you know, infill perspectives. Do you see this as an opportunity to put some parameters around that for alternate uses of different types of energy? Because I know Councillor Schreier, myself, and Councillor Borwati, Councillor Borwati's ward recently had a multi-family living arrangement being explored. And that was one of the questions I had, was on geothermal. They have a large parking lot. And my understanding is part of geothermal is you need, you know, if it's a large multifamily, you need significant land in order to take advantage of that. But geothermal was not being undertaken because, as I understand, some of those incentives have been removed for that. Is that accurate?
Well, I think that's really an important aspect of this motion, is to provide incentive for the kinds of approaches to new developments that you're talking about. It puts more incentive into not being stopped by the first thing that you see that might stand in your way. Instead, to carry on until it is realized, and things like installing geothermal, as Ken Clausen said earlier, ultimately is the more more affordable approach. If you've got an efficient building, and you incorporate geothermal into the design, you've got a lower cost of building ownership over the long term. And that also reminds me one thing that I wanted to say about the fact that investing in new infrastructure into a dead end like natural gas is wasted money and wasted effort on the part of society. We've got to stop expanding the infrastructure that supports the burning of fossil fuels as a first step.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you for the presentation, Gert, and I always love saying you've got the 4-point agenda on the second page that I've talked to you about before. So I really appreciate that. That stays in my mind from previous presentations, which is good. It bangs, okay, it's not by tomorrow, but these are things you need to work on that are feasible. And which is a naked plug, in fact, for today. We published our new urban ag guidelines that go to a hearing. So they're not adopted yet. They go to a hearing on 15th of March. So I think we're trying to listen on, you know, trying to do more on local urban ag. We have our great champion, Karen Kleger, who works in the planning department, who's steered this thing now almost to the finish line. So hopefully that'll get there. I'll be speaking to that on the 15th. But I think we're trying to listen. We're at least trying to get going and trying to listen. So on the food side, we're going forward, and this motion today hopefully gets us a little further along on the building side. So then, no question, but thank you for your advocacy on it.
Thank you.
All right, Madam Clerk, next delegation.
And the final delegation is Dudley Thompson, chair of the Advocacy Committee for Sustainable Building Manitoba. And Dudley has also provided supporting documentation, which has been republished on the agenda under item 4. Hi, Dudley. Are you? Hello. Oh, you can hear us?
Yes, I can hear. Am I coming through? Yep.
Yes, you can proceed with your presentation.
Okay, thank you very much. Well, thanks very much, Councillor Mays and fellow councillors, for allowing me the opportunity to talk today. I'm presenting on behalf of the Sustainable Building Manitoba as leading their advocacy group. I'm also an architect who has been involved in sustainable design and certification in the city, and many buildings, but Mountain Equipment Co-op and Mandel Hydro Place were two that I spent many years working away on. I think the first thing I want to do is thank Kurt and Ken for their earlier comments. And I think Kurt's been really good to put the whole concept in a much broader perspective. And the Road to Resilience is a really great document. It's a very quick read. If you get a chance to have a look at it, that would be good. But today I'm here to speak about buildings, decarbonizing buildings, and why the motion before you is a first step in making the transformation out of our old ways of thinking. I think it's becoming very evident that one day all our buildings will be carbon free. The option to continue using carbon as a fuel is just not on the table. It's a matter of time. So I think it's globally becoming, that's just the way it's going to be. So the central issue today, as Ken had said earlier, is one of leadership. And I think the motion today is a really progressive one, and it starts us on the road to looking towards zero carbon buildings. And I think the longer it takes for this transition to start and happen, the more it's going to cost us all in Winnipeg, and the less competitive Winnipeg is going to be. Buildings built today with gas are going to need to be upgraded in the not too distant future. And buildings that are not using carbon fuels, that are using electricity, basically, are enhancing our local economy because they're creating jobs in Manitoba, and they're creating more cash that is going to be spent in Manitoba as opposed to going to carbon-based economies. As stated in the motion, the Winnipeg Climate Action Plan, initiated and adopted by Council in 2018, committed to this low carbon pathway. And part of the commitment was a reduction of 12% in carbon by commercial buildings and 8% in residential buildings. And 8% is 25,000 homes by 2030. And that's what you have committed to in the Climate Action Plan. So we've got 9 years to retrofit 25,000 homes to get to net zero. So we've got to get moving. While this is not a significant reduction compared to what other jurisdictions in Canada are doing, it appears that the City of Winnipeg is not on target to achieve even these modest goals. I think that's something that we need to really listen to. So the question is, how do we start to achieve the goals? And as the motion before you states, there are two strategies that need to go hand in hand. And I think Ken sort of touched on these earlier. There are two parts to the motion that went forward, or that is going forward. The first is a supply issue, which requires us to switch to non-carbon fuels. And the second is an infrastructure issue to reimagine the way we build and operate buildings. So there's two pieces to it. So the first one, on the supply side, the motion recommends a timeline to halt the use of natural gas in the city. And I think, unlike almost all other cities, large cities in Canada, Winnipeg is in the enviable position of having low-cost, zero-carbon alternative energy source already on hand. It's available, and it's even delivered to every building in Manitoba. As Ken had said, the city needs to work with Manitoba Hydro to ensure that the inadequate generating capacity is available to switch to electric heating and cooling. I think that's what Ken was talking about, is including them as stakeholders, and that's important. And Hydro is certainly aware. I mean, this is not news, despite what was put in the paper the other day by the spokesman for Hydro. Hydro is very aware that Winnipeg, like all other cities in the world, will be transitioning away from carbon. So they will be going to electricity. They're also aware that other utilities like Hydro-Quebec are increasing zero carbon capacity by investing in solar and wind. An article in the Globe about 2 weeks ago saying that Hydro-Quebec is not building any more generating plants. They are going strictly with solar and wind. And do you know why? Because it's cheaper. Wind is delivering electricity at 6 cents a kilowatt hour in Quebec. You can't build, even the existing hydro plants can't deliver at that price. So, and I think the important thing there is too, that these sources, wind and power, wind and solar, have dropped 70% in the last 10 years, and they are more cost-effective than hydro. However, we can't expect the hydro grid to suddenly heat all our leaky buildings, and this is the issue I think others were talking about this morning. So that brings us to the second strategy, and that's carbon reduction, upgrading the performance of buildings. So you can't just switch from gas buildings to electric buildings. You have to upgrade, you have to retrofit the existing buildings. The process to decarbonize building is clear whether it's new or retrofits. There's three steps to it. The first thing is you upgrade the thermal envelope to reduce energy demand. You just add insulation, seal buildings, so you're reducing the overall amount of energy. The second one is to install electric heat pumps or geothermal systems, as Ken and Kurt have talked about, with higher coefficients of efficiency. So rather than just an electric baseboard that takes 100% electricity off the grid, the new heat pumps are for every unit of electricity they use, you get 3 to 4 to 5 units of heat or cooling. And the third one is to utilize rooftop solar photovoltaics to increase the localized green energy supply at the source. So you're creating energy in the building, in the exact building environment, feeding it into the grid and using it later. And the example that Ken had talked this morning, for example, switching from raw electric to geothermal will cut electricity in half and carbon in half, and will produce considerable savings for the owner and also for the utility. So many jurisdictions are already showing the way by targeting serious reductions toward net zero retrofits and new buildings. Toronto is on target for 100% near zero carbon new buildings by 2030. They're on target for that. It's happening. They're doing it. And 100% of existing buildings retrofitted to 40% of what they're using now by 2050. I think that's a bit of a stretch, but on their books, that's where they're going. Vancouver has developed a step code to encourage increased conformance to low carbon buildings. Edmonton, as I've said before, has declared a climate emergency and is looking at very radical upgrading of buildings to get to where they need to go. Montreal just issued 46 strategies to net zero by 2030. And as Ken said, many cities in the US have banned natural gas altogether. So there's a lot's happening. There are a lot of precedents out there that we can learn from. But I think that the transition away from carbon is a massive change. Like this is one of the epoch changes that is going to be happening before us. And it's not going to be easy. To answer many of the motions that are put forward is going to be complex, and they're interrelated. So to phase out natural gas infrastructure in neighborhoods, and maintain operating costs, you've got to retrofit the homes. So in order to retrofit the homes or build all new electric ones, there needs to be improved bylaws and funding sources with tested solutions. And funding needs to be defined and challenged. Fortunately, there are a lot of answers for some of these questions. We've talked about green bonds with Councillor Mays as an opportunity to raise capital to do retrofits and upgrade to new standards. City of Toronto has done 3 rounds of them at $300 million each. An upgraded building code is in process in the province and will incentivize compliance to net zero standards. And the proposed residential infill strategy that your city council is going to be voting on will increase the density and sustainability in Winnipeg neighborhoods. Another piece that is in the puzzle. The Canadian Federation of Municipalities has funds for new approaches and looking at new transitions. And Efficiency Manitoba, who we're going to be talking to in about 10 minutes, provides incentives and resources for more efficient buildings. And they have people on staff that can help with these motions. So hopefully we can cross-introduce, make these things happen. What has been lacking is the vision and the will to change. This motion can change everything. So just if we can imagine that major infill projects now under active consideration and development, such as the Parker Lands, U of M, Southwood Lands, Capion.
Are you wrapping up? Because you're at your time.
Yep, just done. I didn't know it was that long. But just imagine some of these new lands that you have control over, they could be developed as all electric buildings. So imagine also that if the city of Winnipeg initiated immediate leadership in this area and ensured that every new capital project was net zero and hundreds of existing city-owned buildings are transitioning away from gas, that would be the very best case, best practice example, so others in the city can see the vision. Thanks very much, and I urge you to pass the motion. Any questions, I'd be glad to answer.
Councillor Schreier.
Sure, Mr. Thompson. You had mentioned Manitoba Hydro's response to this motion. What do you have to say in terms of our ability, our capacity at this point to begin and continue on a notable conversion to non-renewables, including hydro, at least for the next decade or so, given that we're in the export, given that we have an export potential for hydro, and that at this point, at least, our neighbors, our American neighbors to whom we export, have reduced their imports due to fracking at this time.
Yeah, that's a tough one. I think currently about 25% of our electricity generated every year by Manitoba Hydro is sent south as an export, and obviously as income for the province. And that's our cushion. I mean, we have that to fall back on in the short term. I think that the thing we have to realize is this transition is not going to happen fast. It's going to be a very slow additive element, both in electric cars and electrifying homes. And I think the point that Ken made earlier is if we start using heat pumps and air-to-air or geothermal, whatever it is, they are going to be, we have about a quarter of the homes in Winnipeg are on electric baseboard heat, very inefficient. If we started converting them to geothermal, then all the electricity freed up would be going back into the system. If we enabled more people to have more incentive for solar, again, there's a whole other level of energy that can go back into the system. But I think it's something that, and as I said earlier, especially with wind and solar now, big utilities are investing in them. And I'm sure Hydro is, as they have done before, going to add wind and solar farms to their infrastructure capabilities to look at. I mean, from a business point of view, we want your product. This is a really good product. And if I was running Manitoba Hydro, I'd be out there building as much alternative as I can to be able to sell it to Manitobans and Americans. Lots of potential.
Thank you.
Okay. Councillor Neeson had a question. We'll take a break after the delegations. Is our last delegation, Madam Clerk?
Okay. I'll have a little preamble because, I don't think America needs our fuel. We've seen them become much more energy independent. I know pre-COVID, I took a lovely drive from Winnipeg using my carbon-sourced vehicle. As a family, we drove to Florida. And along the way, I could not get over the amount of solar fields because of the deregulation in the United States. A lot of private energy producers with solar farms. I did see a number of wind farms as well on the route. Though I also saw coal, natural gas, a lot of coal trains moving back and forth on that journey. In Manitoba, bringing it back to here, yes, we've invested in dams in the north. We've got dams on the Winnipeg River that have been there for many, many years. From a wind energy perspective, we had under the previous administration, provincially, a private third party that was incentivized to come and set up solar farms down south on the road towards Emerson. And I believe Manitoba Hydro had to buy them out. And I believe subsequent to that, they expanded that farm. from a solar perspective, I haven't seen a lot here on that. We know the boondoggles that happened in Ontario. The $5,000, you know, build your nice little square hydro or solar panel, we'll buy the energy back. Except they didn't have a plan how to connect it back to the network to do such a thing. That was under the Wynn government. It was a huge boondoggle. You know, Ontario has a lot of generation from nuclear. I lived in Ontario for a decade between Point, or I always find my way around nuclear plants, Darlington and Pickering. I lived between those two plants in Oshawa. It was always a challenge because Pickering had a lot of heavy water leaks, but nonetheless, it's been generating in Ontario for many years. So I'll ask you the same sort of thing from a perspective of decarbonizing. There's a lot of carbon needed to do wind energy, to manufacture it, to operate it. I believe it's lubricated by oil products. How do you see alternative energy on source generation? Now, I know our motion's talking about residential, but is there a way to bring it off grid, to make a house off grid, I guess is my question to you.
Yes, I think there are many off-grid homes. I think it's a question when you've got, when you're in an urban area. I'm working on a small housing co-op right now, and we are going to be net zero, which means that we are essentially off-grid, except the grid's there, and we're using it to feed in when we have lots of power and to take back when we need some. And I think that's the sensible way to do it in an urban environment. But at the same time, all our rooftops will be solar, so that we will be generating enough power. And Manitoba has abundance of power. And I know the Manitoba Hydro building, if you look at the solar greenhouse on the south facade of that building, when it's 30 degrees below zero outside, it's plus 60 Celsius inside at the top of the greenhouse. That's the heat. And that heat is used to heat the building through the winter. And that can be captured in many different ways throughout the province. So I think there's lots of ways to capture back and to enable us to become much more efficient with what we use. And I think the issue here is private business, the market is what's running the future of decarbonization. If you look at the reason they're not building pipelines is because no banks want to support them, no private companies want to be there because it's just not cost effective. There's not a 40-year horizon for making a pipeline profitable. And the same thing goes with gas and oil. Fracking is bankruptcies are happening all over the place in America because they're just not, they're depending on subsidies, and it's not happening anymore. Sorry.
Yes. So just because you're, you know, one of the individuals before us today and hearing about net zero and getting away from or a carbon free, how do you propose things like windows to be made carbon free or electrical wiring because it's covered in plastic coating?
And I mean, that's going to take a generation to transfer over. I mean, I think you're seeing it on every level. It's the market again that is, if there's a better way, a cheaper way, a greener way to do it, the market will come up with it and the old will just be left behind. In the meantime, we're going to be using cellophane and coverings for wires that are made from oil. And I think that is probably, I'm guessing, but 1% of the carbon production is from production of products that can't immediately be off-sourced to green new types of product. But I mean, I think we're going to be living with both for a long time.
One more.
Last one.
Okay.
So you, and I believe I tweaked on it. You indicated one generation. What's your definition of one generation?
When you think that 2 years ago, if someone had told you that General Motors would announce that within 12 years they would not be producing combustion engine vehicles, you would have said, I don't think so. But it's done, and they will be there, and so is everybody else. I mean, I remember looking at the transfer from coal to gas, it took years and years. We're going from where we are right now to non-carbon future, and we don't know how long it's going to take, but it's happening so fast in so many different parts of the world. And that's why it's so important that we pass this motion today, because we need to be competitive. This city needs to, and we have, the irony is, we have the tool, we have the infrastructure already in place with Manitoba Hydro.
I think Councillor Nathan has a follow-up
question. Yeah, because this is, you know, from my layman, this is not my end-all and be-all, but from what I understand, we might be divesting or on this rapid transition, but I see it more as we've offloaded. So we look at places like China. They continue to add coal plants. They continue to really accelerate their carbon use. So as we transition, are we not just offloading it?
I think China is, they're the biggest investor and the biggest producer of solar cells. They have massive investments in wind power. I think they're the same as all the rest of us. Their timeline, I mean, who knows what their timeline is, but they will be making the transition the same as everybody else's, and there are short-term needs that they have to accomplish for whatever reason. But sooner or later, the arc of history, if you want, is going to decarbonization, no matter where you are. And pretty soon the markets and the economy and the finances won't be going to oil.
Okay. I think that's it for questions. Your budget presentation did get under my skin, I have to say, Dudley. So good. We've met a few times since then. So it's good. This is an outflow of that your group's budget, pointing out that we'd put some targets out there and we needed to either do something or admit that we just weren't even going to drop. So thank you for that.
I appreciate everything you're doing, Councillor. Thank you very much.
Okay. Well, colleagues, we'll take a break. It's 10 after. John, what do you want? 5 minutes? Do you want 10 minutes and then we'll reconvene?
10.
Okay. Thank you for that. Got it. 10 minutes then. We'll resume in 10 minutes. Thank you. Sorry for the delay. That was my fault. But we're back. So, we're just underway here. Okay. The elegantly named delegation of authority and then et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, on the Headworks facility. I don't think we have, in short, we haven't got the report back yet.
No. It's a work in process right now. So we're not here with it today.
I mean, this will be good and big news when it comes, because that Headworks is, as you've said in the past, even if the lake cleaned itself, I'll paraphrase, even if the lake cleaned itself, we'd still be doing this because we've got an old facility. Okay, so you require an extension of?
Yeah, we'll say give us 30 days.
Okay.
Yeah, so April.
Councillor Nathan, can you move a 30-day extension?
So moved.
Agreeable, thank you. All those in favor of an extension, aye. Okay, that's one down. That's approved. Number two, not dissimilar. This actually is a pretty big undertaking, which would involve the shrinking capacity of our biosolid, well, the plant plant isn't shrinking, our ability to process is shrinking. And we have the different RMs out there with different legal entitlements. No report yet. Frankly, I was surprised we only gave you 90 days to do this when I went back and looked at it. So the request here is for another 90 days, as I understand it.
Yeah, I think so, because I think it's really in reference to what was recommendation number 3, which was directed specifically to Rosser and West St. Paul. There's also a requirement in the report that we come back with a semi-annual verbal report, which in my estimation would be in June. So I think we could update on both in June if that's, I guess that is 90 days. Because we have started discussions with Rosser and West St. Paul, but we don't have any update right now.
Yes, I misremembered number 3 there as being St. Andrews. I think that must have been a different one. But yeah, we have the service sharing agreements with RM of Rosser and RM of West St. Paul. Then we have the anomalous business, the MOU with St. Andrews.
Correct.
It's got a separate
1800 unit.
Thank you, 1800 unit. Thank you, Sean. 1800 unit issue there. Councillor Mason, that should be more formal. Okay, so the request then is for a 90-day extension. Councillor Ellicott, are you moving that, or did you have a question?
Just a quick question, just to make sure we're clarifying. The report will come back with, I believe by that time, the agreement will be signed. But with St. Andrews, is that correct?
Yeah, right now, Councillor, we are working, the Department of Legal Services are working with St. Andrews and their legal counsel. So I would expect that we will have a signed agreement by June, but with the conditions, with the cap of the 1800 for existing and new development.
So that's good to hear. There seemed to be a little bit of confusion that it was only for the new development, the 1800, because they also have other properties that are coming online with the pipe as well. But it's total. That's the number total, new, existing, or new.
Okay. That's correct. It's total, because there's a number of existing properties that are ready to connect, right?
Yeah.
So
yeah.
It is all, it's existing and correct.
And that'd be for, and again, I'm going to make the assumption that'll be for the other use agreements. Are we also going to get a little bit of information about future requirements? I know Rosser are quite concerned because they have some developments in the queue right now that they want to go forward with. And I'm equally concerned about the amount of discharge that those new developments will produce. Some of it may be pulse plants again. So are we going to be, in the report, will we be seeing some of the future requests as well, as not only what is happening, where we are now, but also what the other pressures in the future are?
That's a great question, Councillor. We are working with Rosser right now. Rosser did have a number of submissions. We've asked for additional information.
Okay.
So what's been happening since the report came late last year is Water and Waste has been working with those municipalities, working with planning, property, and development. So we'll be having ongoing discussions with those communities, absolutely. Also, you know, it involves really, it's legal services, water and waste, and planning, property, and development. And, you know, we're looking to mitigate the impacts of service sharing. And you know, I think we have the obligation to come back with a verbal report semi-annually, but depending upon the extent of discussions we have over the next few months, we may come back with a written submission, because I think it's very important. It's very important to council and the city. So all of those things are happening right now.
Thank you.
Okay, so does someone want to move an extension then of 90 days?
I just wanted to ask a quick question.
Okay, Councilor Nason asked a question then. Yeah, we have the motion, fire away.
Just from a perspective of multiple things being in the hopper by the RM of Rosser, do we hold the power of veto basically over their development?
There is no there is no veto provision, if you will, in the agreement. There's some emergency clauses in the agreement and what that would constitute, but I think what we're going to try to do is to work collaboratively with them, because I think the those agreements that were executed back in the day had no cap on the amount of servicing. With West St. Paul or Ross or West St. Paul's primarily residential, I don't think it's as big a concern, but we are working with Rosser to understand what their demands, what their asks may be. And there's also development in Rosser is also governed by a special planning district. David Jopling is the city's representative on that planning district. I think that was a recent appoint. Council had to appoint that. So there's some provisions in there. So I think that planning district, that also comes into play with these conversations, which is why we're working with PP&D as well.
So we're already moving in more of a metro regional planning kind of thing?
That planning district, the Centerport planning district, has existed for years. I'm not sure what created, but that's been around for a while.
Okay, thank you.
All right, I think Councillor Orlico then had moved a 90-day extension on item number two. All those in favor?
Aye.
All right, thank you.
Item number three will be familiar. This is disappeared on our agenda last time. I asked for a 30-day layover to get feedback from some concerned groups. They're not here, so... There were some issues with the study and people having being required to sign a non-disclosure, but I kind of feel like people have had their opportunity to weigh in, and we do not have that. This doesn't go up the chain, right, Madam Clerk? This
correct. This is just directing the public service to report back, so this would stay at this committee for that.
Do we have a time frame on when that's to come back? I don't think we do. Do we?
Doesn't specifically state a time frame in the recommendations that were submitted with the report. So if the committee would like to add that direction.
A year. Yeah, like if we just left it open-ended, but I would say at least 180 days.
Okay.
Hearing the dialogue that we had earlier about getting off natural gas for heating, yet you know we're looking to sell natural gas here, set up distribution. It's kind of a
methane.
I don't know. It's challenging, but my question that I have is, who's validated these numbers from the administration? Has the city auditor looked at these numbers?
No. We worked with a consultant. The team that works on this, we have finance people embedded within solid waste. So it was operations, engineering, and finance were part of this study. I mean, it's really, it's an estimate of the cost to construct a facility and what the market rates are for the reuse. So we would not have had the city auditor. I mean, I think the city auditor only looks at audits capital costs and massive projects. I'm not even sure what it is. I know the city auditor's audited the estimates on the north end, but something this would not be within that materiality level.
So it's just like from a perspective of another set of eyes, you know, the independence, you know, like these are significant undertakings. It mentions 24 million proposed income or in the positive, just to make sure that from a city's, you know, independence, fairness, that you know, if there's that step there. I'm just asking that question.
So work with Hydro and on the numbers and what the values were for the gas we produce. They work with our own staff with regards to the amount of production that we're seeing through our flaring system, so IGRS. So, you know, as far as are the numbers, they took a low, so they went to the low end. This is like based on the lowest production on gas and selling it at the current market rates. You know, so I mean, as far as validating it, I mean, and Lauren is on Zoom if we want to ask her, but she's the consultant from the consultant firm. But the reality is, I mean, they've done their due diligence and they've worked with all the parties involved to get these numbers. So.
Yeah, and we do. I mean, there's a due diligence piece, right, with many embedded assumptions and conservative estimates with a team of you know, a multifunctional expert team looking at this. So, I mean, one of the things that we're doing, what we're asking for in this report is let us go off and do further detailed analysis and come with options. So, you know, this was the business case that was developed, and no, we didn't involve anybody from outside the department. I mean, of course, finance always looks at it. Finance signs off on the FIS statements and corporate finance looks at it, that sort of thing. So city auditor had no involvement, but others do look at this outside of the department for sure.
Just, you know, over the years, there's been experts that have signed off on things and cross-functional teams, and, you know, it's come back to bite us down the road. So I'm just asking the question from the perspective of due diligence. And, you know, I respectfully acknowledge that you said due diligence has been done, but, you know, we've got our East Water plant that, you know,
your approval,
diligence failed.
Yeah, Council, your approval today will allow us to go down that path to get you those, like the business case and the class three estimates, which are pretty high level,
class three is pretty drilled in.
Yeah, class three estimate and then the building design and construction development. So we'll have a much better idea on the costing side of piece of it. But as far as the revenue generating ability, that's, I mean, the numbers are the numbers. So.
Okay, Councilor Schreier, I think, had a question.
Yeah, sorry, just for the record, can you remind us what is the margin of accuracy for a class three estimate?
30 to 50.
Plus 30 minus 20. But this is, we don't have a class three yet, Councillor. We need a class three to even put anything into the budget. So what we're saying is this will get us to
that class three.
That we want to go off and develop a class three estimate.
Yeah.
And that's plus 30 minus 20.
The direction would be go do a class three estimate, because right now we're at five, class five maybe. And this is just whatever we got out of the spec.
Yeah. So if I may, Mr. Chair.
Sure.
What is the cost to get to a class three estimate?
That's in here. That's
out
of reserves we would be using.
We have 2.5.
2.5, yeah. Okay.
Set aside for this in the capital budget.
Okay. Yeah, I did capture that number. Okay. Okay.
Okay. Why don't I hand the chair? I'm the one who delayed it, so I'll hand the chair to Councillor Nason, and I'll move. We don't have anybody here speaking against, so on we go. So I'll move the recommendation to the public service, in essence, but with a 180-day time frame.
At the minimum.
And that's to get the business case and the class three estimate and the other stuff that's in the recommendations.
Maybe we need a bit more time to speed it, because we'll still have to go out and hire the consultant.
181.
Could we say,
can we take fall. It to the like fall?
Yeah, like so maybe like the third quarter of this year. So sweet. That would be like 100. That's October.
Yeah, 180 days from today's meeting is October.
I guess it's 6 months.
Is that?
Yeah. That's
okay. Sorry, that's good. I just wanted to make sure that we wouldn't under deliver.
Only the city would have been. It's gone bad anyway.
October would be. 180 days in August is September, is it not?
You're a second behind me making that conclusion. Okay, so thanks. We'll kick it then to November.
Sure, that would
all
be
right. That would
be
November helpful. Meeting.
So defined be 210 days for November then.
Sure. Beauty. We'll move a 210-day time frame, and we'll see where we are if any of us are still
Anybody doubling down on that?
Councillor Nason, Chair Nason. Yep. Point of order.
Recognize the speaker from East Kildonan.
East Kildonan and Elmwood. You got both kinds here. So I believe that's 240 days, is it not?
No, I know. I would say that.
Councillor, there's no meeting in the month of August.
Okay, point well taken. Thank you.
That's why we're designating the month as a meeting.
I couldn't agree.
And discussion, once the motion's moved, I have discussion, please.
All righty, the motion's been moved. Councillor Schreier?
Thank you, Chair Nason. Yes, I'm glad we're going in this direction with concerns, but nonetheless, I believe we need to do this. We need to try. We need to see what the administration can come up with. There's no perfection to this in my mind, but I still think it's good for the economy and good for the environment. Personally, I see the economy and environment intertwined. We're talking always in both cases about limited resources. And when you're not talking about limited resources, you're not talking about the environmental challenges or economic challenges. And so, you know, sometimes your environmental decisions can look skewed or your economic decisions can look skewed. But bear in mind, when we're talking about using a combustion energy, bear in mind, my hope is that we're using this in lieu of natural gas, which is a fossil fuel, not to be confused with methane from biomass, which is renewable, because we create this every year. When we have natural gas in the ground, we want to keep it there as long as possible. When we got oil in the ground, we want to keep it there as long as possible. I'm not denying that these are valuable fuels. They're very valuable. And we want to limit them for more than environmental reasons. We want to limit their use for economic reasons because they're so valuable. The worst thing we can do is subsidize the use of fossil fuels from the ground. They're so valuable in terms of, you know, what a cubic meter of natural gas is worth or a drop of oil, that we want to use them as little as possible to maintain them for future generations. Because don't kid yourself. They're very valuable, they're very meaningful, and we will be needing them, you know, to one extent to the other in the future. The fact that we've gone blown through over half of the reserves of fossil fuels in a century, you know, what a look back on history and talk about what doesn't last very long. What a bizarre era. But I mean, not to blame any individual, I'm just saying that's who we are as a civilization or as a species. So, but in this case, if we're going to be using, if we're still hooked up to natural gas or whatever, let's try to limit the amount of natural gas we use from the ground and leave that in the ground. That's the best storage place. And replace it where we can with biomass methane from projects such as this. And that's where the environment and economics in terms of sustainability of both intertwine is something like right here, making a hard-nosed decision and saying, yeah, we're going to use some greenhouse gas emitting fuels, but it's in order to actually reduce the amount that we're taking from the ground that we can leave for future generations. And there lies the huge difference.
Okay, thank you for those brief comments. Councillor Orlico has none. I'll call the question. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Carried. Chair, back to you, sir.
Thank you. So we're on to the next item, which is the one, numerous submissions, some delegations. This is the natural gas related motion. I know Councillor Orlico has some amendments to the be it resolved part of it. I'll just say before we begin, I want to thank Councillor Schreier for really bringing this issue
forward, I would say, and speaking on the floor of council and talking about, it isn't, you know, part of our challenge here in terms of the greenhouse gases is this issue, is the heating of buildings. It isn't all just, we talk a lot about compost, we talk about density, we talk about transportation. There's this other part too called buildings, and we really need to think about that. So here we go. So kudos to Councillor Schreier on that. And
thank you.
My friend Rob Altmaier has many times over coffee said to me, you really got to do something about buildings, and it's in your climate change report. So my thanks to him for encouraging / chiding me to do something on this. So here we are. I would like it to go forward, but that needs 3 votes. So we're going to have to work on something here if we're going to get this thing to go forward today. I think then, Madam Clerk, procedurally, I should turn it over to Councillor Urlacho, and he can speak to the amendments that we're all sort of juggling things here. But John, if you'd like to, can you speak to the amendments that you'd like to see?
Yeah, well, thank you very much. Yeah, absolutely supporting this. This is to me, I know I'm not trying to in any way try to impede this. Really do want to make it successful. This is an issue, and again, Councillor Schreier, we've heard you, and this is a process what you do. You have an issue you feel passionate about that you want the city to go forward with. You make the motion, and then we debate it, and then we go forward or not. In this case especially, definitely supportive of the idea of reduction in fossil fuels. Now, just because I'm supportive of it, we have to do it with some concern, as we heard today. Councillor Schreier, I also agree with you that we could look at laying this over. However, I want to instill a sense of urgency in getting this moving, because I'm already saying we should give it 180 days to come back. I could go a little less, but again, the extent of the original motion is quite comprehensive. And we really do want to align up to our climate action plan with the strategies and timelines, with a proper public input, as we heard today, with some examples of other municipalities and what they're doing. So after listening to the report, I think Councillor Mays's initial motion is substantially perfect. It just has some little structural things that I want to look at, including more of, instead of having the report come back first, I'd like to come back all together with all those pieces together, because the public input into what reductions are for carbon reduction strategies are pretty important. So I've emailed the possible amendments to you. I'm open to some changes. I know I don't really like, you know, doing these on the fly as much as that, but again, there is urgency. If we talk about motions that need to go forward because there's urgency, I think we have another one today from Councillor Nason potentially coming forward. They're urgent. In my sense, that it's an urgent, because it's in the same vein of we can't wait another day to protect the environment and save our world for the future generations. So again, but we also have cost constraints, and there really is. I've been in the recycling world since my early 20s, in the environment world, and I wish there was an easy, simplistic answer to how to do all this, but there isn't. There's cost. There's some pros and cons. And you know, we're going to have to look at that, but I'm not the expert, especially, and we heard some today. So, but we need to have that come back to us first before we decide to go embark on this great idea. So I just emailed you just 4 points, pretty well in 180 days with a strategy and timelines to achieve, our action, plan targets in carbon reduction. Now, again, I broke it into 2 parts. One is what we can do ourselves, which is right away, looking at converting existing and new City Winnipeg-owned buildings and assets, but then also looking citywide. Councillor Mays was very convincing to me the other day about, you know, we need to be looking as a city as a whole. But we also need to engage with the UDI and other development groups and businesses to see how that can be done. And again, there may be opportunities just to do electric more, but there may be also some need to do some other types of renewable energy as well, rather than just defaulting to natural gas or other types of fossil fuels. And then the other one is to look at the other municipalities and carbon reduction. Winnipeg's fantastic sometimes in the ability to take other ideas from other cities and Winnipegize it. So I think that's something that should be part of the report. Number three was getting hold of those stakeholders, Winnipeg Hydro, sustainable buildings and the groups out there, to get their feedback on how, on those two main points about how to become more carbon neutral or reduce our carbon footprint. And then pretty well, the fourth is an actionable. So I'm not sure if that has to be severed, that has to go up the chain, or it could just be to report back. But let's go look at some of our buildings now. While I really like the idea of reducing to renewable energy is number one goal, we also have to look at retrofits. We heard that today, and that's a number two. We have to be looking at not only converting and existing to renewable energies, but also retrofitting our buildings. That includes insulation, new windows, what gives us the best environmental bang for our buck. We like to do everything at once, but we need to be moving forward and not to be held up in the smaller problems of like, well, we don't have enough to do it all. Well, let's do something. Let's keep moving forward, keep the ball rolling, as I say, because we really can't wait. So the amendment here is there in front of you. Again, I think it hits all the points of the initial motion with a few additions that I mentioned before. Thank you.
Good point of order. If I may?
No, you turn. I'm here.
Your turn.
Okay, go ahead, Jake. Councillor Schreier.
Thank you, Brian. Councillor Mays. Are these considered friendly amendments? I just want to see where we are in the structure of these amendments. I assume they are.
Motion is on the agenda for the committee's consideration. Whatever motion the committee would ultimately like to make, whether it be what is written on the agenda or something different, is up to the committee.
Yeah, whether we take the clerks or...
Yeah, I'm fine with it. My only concern being I don't want to go down the number... I don't see number three as kicking an entire new Office of Public Engagement consultation process in multiple official languages spreading across the city. That will take more than 180 days itself. So I don't think that was Councilor Ehrlich's intent. He just talked about stakeholders. So I'm fine with what Councilor Ehrlich has laid out. I do not see that as triggering. We are doing enough public engagement exercises as it is, in my view, and perhaps maybe more than we can handle in a pandemic. So I don't see number three as kicking that in.
So you didn't answer Councillor Schreier.
Yes.
Friendly amendments?
Yes.
Okay.
That's the answer.
So my concern was on the public engagement. Who are we engaging, to what level, getting educated next week on the Office of Public Engagement, because I had some harsh criticism about the who, because it seems to be the regular, a regular group of individuals who are dedicated and passionate about whatever area of interest they may have. I think we have 15 councillors and a mayor that could do some public engagement on our own on this matter. To get a sense of where our community sits on this. Since this motion idea came forward, I have heard some very hostile criticism of this approach. I look at it as an opportunity, right? If people decide to live in a lower carbon housing development, that should be their choice. But there's a price to be paid for that.
That is a fair comment.
So that's my lens that I have on this at present. But I'm supportive of it in general.
Yeah,
where does it sit on priority scale for the department?
I think the clerk has clarified that, yeah, number three is a stakeholder engagement. There were a couple of specific groups included in a previous draft, but it also said included but not limited to. So this would, I think the department would be talking to people like the Home Builders Association and Sustainable Energy Groups, and
but no public engagement.
But yeah, but this is not another voyage. I mean, the time frame would just be very long, I think, if we did.
Well, and there's so many other things going on that are higher priority. Sure. But does this fit into our Winnipeg and complete community?
Yes. The motion does fit into that. It's a part of our climate action plan, which is part of our complete communities, which is part of our Winnipeg. So it's quite a bit in there, and it's littered throughout. We have a very strong, that's why we put the climate action plan, which is part of our Winnipeg, if we, at which time, if adopted, our Winnipeg. But yeah, absolutely. Back to the feedback. No, it was a public consultation. We haven't decided what we're doing yet. Timelines. This is just to get a report back. If council is more, gets this information back and goes, you know, ready to go, let's start asking. That'd be the next step, would be after that step of if we decide to go forward, which I really hope we would. But again, I want to see the information come back from the administration first. Then that would be the public engagement. Now, the stakeholders are those ones, Hydro, you know, the Home Builders Association, groups that are already quite on the level, and it'd be a high level. I can change the wording there, I'm not sure how, but it would be really a high level, which I'm pretty sure the department would do regardless. But it was just mentioned today to make sure that's pointed out.
Okay. And we've staffed up in the Office of Sustainability with our excellent Food Council coordinator. Jeanette's moved over into Office of Sustainability. So we're starting to staff up. We do have some capacity there. Hopefully this would be a good project. Sorry.
Just in terms of preparing this report, I mean, well, I mean, there's groups external to the city that we would need to speak to, you know, particularly Manitoba Hydro and others, folks that we heard from today in delegation, but it also will involve other city departments. So we need to get planning, property and development involved in this, as well as municipal accommodations, which is now in the asset management portfolio. So and potentially community services for some of their facilities. So it's one of those. I mean, there's folks outside the organization, there's other departments within the city that would need to be part of this. And just in terms of the climate action plan, and we still have an obligation to come back and report to the committee on some of the work that we've been doing. We've had, we're on our third Office of Sustainability managers since it came to me in August. So we had Lindsay Moreau is on leave. We hired somebody to fill the position temporarily that left the employee of the city for work elsewhere. And now we have Becky Radix, who's acting as the manager of the Office of Sustainability. So we've had a lot of turnover in that office. So we're a little behind on a couple of other things, but hopefully we're, you know, we're reaching a point of stability and filling some vacant positions, albeit there's not many in that office, which is why we would need 180 days.
Yeah, I think it's if there's any further discussion, I'm fine with the amendments. I do think we need to do something. I think we need to get going. As somebody said to me, you guys talked about Parker lands for 8 or 9 years and nobody ever said, hey, that's, how's that going to be heated? That's like whatever, we landed on 1837 new units potentially, and it was a fair question. So if we can at least start asking that question and saying, okay, you know, maybe we should retrofit 3 arenas. Which 3? I have no idea. Like, then you'd get into the public engagement, I think. And there's probably, I don't know. I mean, you wouldn't retrofit when you're about to close, all of that sort of stuff. So, but at least let's put the question here and let's get going. Councillor Schreier.
Yeah, I just want to state again, this may, and I don't want to exaggerate. I don't think I'm prone to sensationalism at City Hall, if I am, where, but I will say in this case, this might be, it may very well be this motion we're about to deal with within seconds, depending on how long my diatribe is here, might be the most important, influential motion on the environment of the generation in terms of the city. And so let's get going, but it will need a lot of discussion. And so I'm pleased with the amendments from Councillor Orlico and Councillor Mays. Thanks so much for taking note of these things that I take very, very dearly. Thank you very much. And for Councillor Nason, a prolific researcher, and I think I've thanked him before for his research in the past. Interesting to see the influence that his further research will have on the discussion on this in the months to come. Thank you.
I'm just curious which we're preparing to vote on.
Okay, why don't I'll hand you the chair and I'll move to I'll move adoption of the motion, though, as amended by the amendments put forward by Councillor Orlico.
Would you like me to read it?
That would be, so all of the rather lengthy and and characteristic for me, whereas staff survives and then it's changed.
Therefore, be it resolved that the Winnipeg Public Service be directed to report back within 180 days on the following. One, a strategy and timeline to assist in achieving the City of Winnipeg Climate Action Plan targets by A, converting existing and new city-owned buildings and infrastructure to renewable energy, and B, requirements of new development citywide, both public and private, for the use of renewable energy. Two, a review of other municipalities' carbon reduction strategies and timelines. Three, was the most recent version I sent to you. I'm not sure if you're comfortable with this, Councillor Orlico, but please let me know. Feedback from other stakeholders regarding the use of renewable energy in new and existing public and private buildings throughout the City of Winnipeg. Okay. Four, an environmental assessment to determine existing City of Winnipeg assets that would provide the highest environmental benefit by converting to renewable energy, retrofit, and or other environmental upgrades that best reduces energy use.
And report back in 180 days? Was that in there?
Yes, the start of the resolve is directing the public service report back.
One more. I'm suggesting one more minor amendment because of the language and conversation we heard today from some of the delegations. I want to be very specific that the review be contained to Canadian municipalities.
So changing number two to read a review of other Canadian municipalities' carbon reduction strategies and timelines?
By me.
Okay, so I'll move that.
Oh, sorry, yeah, I have to check. Question, all those in favor?
Yes.
Opposed? Well, that would be
very good.
Carried unanimously.
All right, thank you. Thanks, Councillor Trier. Now, hopefully a somewhat easier section of the agenda, although we're making good time here. All right, number five, five, six, and seven are similar in nature. Councillor Nason, do you want to speak to item number five?
Yeah, so I moved item five and then the rest followed me. I moved it from a perspective of understanding the complexity of the public service and the amount of demands on them, seeking a verbal report because the Transcona West area had, you know, was planned out as an area plan, but I've now come up against a couple times where we've done plan approval only to find out that there's capacity issues. So wanting to get an understanding for the remaining build out, what we have, because we're hearing that there's capacity issues in the City of Winnipeg. And why I'm wanting to know that if the area structure plan has enough capacity to deliver what the area is planned out to do. And it was very specific in the areas in the appendix of that motion.
The capacity issue for the city and you know, there's the overall capacity issue, which deals with the city, we just spoke about the biosolids capacity. There's that capacity. There's capacity issues and requirements depending upon whether or not you're in a combined sewer area that hasn't been relieved yet in terms of application of Clause 8 of the license. There's requirements depending upon what actual development goes in. I mean, there's precinct plans and there's secondary plans, but then when the actual development comes in the servicing, sometimes it varies. The other thing that happens with development in the city is there's no capacity reserved. It's the way the development happens in the City of Winnipeg. It's like development occurs and capacity gets used up. So, you know, there could be a whole area and there's a certain amount of capacity that's been consumed. I think the question of or the ask that what's the capacity in a specific area of the city, that's a difficult question to answer. That takes some engineering analysis and some dialogue. So what we one of the things that we're working on with PP&D right now is looking to make sure those asks come in early, very early, in terms of what the capacity is. And I think that whole process, all of this feeds into that update that we'll give on the overall biosolids capacity. But I think on a area by area, you know, specifically what is the capacity, that's not a question that's easily answered by the public service. And one, I think primarily, I mean, it's resources. If we had endless resources and services development to do that engineering analysis, we could do that. We don't have that. But what we're always open to is developers that are looking at the area to consult with us, and we can respond to what the servicing requirements are. And I mean, the servicing requirements can be, it could be water, it could be sewer, it could be drainage, right? So even when we look at what the servicing requirements are, there's a whole bunch of specialized experts within the department that do that. So to actually say what is the capacity in those areas, I just, you know, without having a whole lot of additional staff and a whole lot of time to do that, I don't think that's a question that we can answer. We can certainly, if there's a developer in the area that wants to understand what the servicing requirements are and what the capacity is, I think we can answer that. We do that all the time. But to say, you know, in this area of the city, how much capacity is left? Because the capacity is always, capacity isn't static either, right? Mm-hmm. Capacity is changes, which is why I think the ask of city council and the obligation of the public services to come back and provide updates on capacity. Biosolids capacity, so that's the solids capacity, but then there's the hydraulic capacity. So, and you know what, sometimes the actual build out of areas can be different than what was envisioned. So I you know what, I know that's not an answer that you want to hear, Councillor Nason, but that's the reality. I think what we can do when we come back in June with a verbal update on capacity, like I think we can, we could come back to committee and speak generally to the types of servicing issues that you might encounter and encourage, like if you have developers in your area that are working, or even if they're early on in the plans, like reach out to us and let's have that early conversation. And you know, the administrative coordinating committee, like I think we need to work more with that, like early on in the process, because there have been instances where you know, plans are going along and then it seems like an 11th hour, you know, you need to do this or you need to do that. Sometimes it can be a communication breakdown between a consultant and a developer. Sometimes it's information that we've asked for. So, and I mean, just in the whole services development area, I'll say that when we're working on updating our multi-year budget, that's something we're going to look at, because we're really, in terms of the demand, with the rate of drawings and development applications and the capacity and monitoring that, we're under resourced to just do what we're trying to do day to day. So
yeah, the challenge where this came out of was, we have Transcona West, pardon me if I get the language of various plans, but I think a structure plan that was planned out for the development of the area. And that community committee, we've had plan approvals that have come. Mm-hmm. Now, my understanding of plan approval is that it's gone through all the different departments to say, is there concerns or issues? What we've had is, after plan approval, then it gets kiboshed for whatever reason. But you know, capacity concerns in the area. It's happened, I think, twice now. There's still further development in the Transcona West area. So, you know, being new to this committee, having we've got 90,000 people units of capacity left in the city of Winnipeg, I'm trying to understand from the Transcona area and, you know, zeroing in on this area for the amount of development that's left in the area and as part of the zoning that is set and established as part of the structure plan, how much capacity is left, even from a ballpark, you know, people units perspective. That's what I'm looking at. So that, you know, when we start talking about South Transcona, to understand, you know, South Transcona, when you start coming as part of our Winnipeg, you know, here's how many units are going to be available in that area. That will be a future consideration. right? We've still got development going on in our city. Transcona is, you know, people want to live there. It's, you know, it's the place to be. And I'm biased about it, but you know, I chose to make that my home. I'm a representative of the area, and I invite everybody to come live in Transcona, because you'll know why people want to live in Transcona. It may be part of Unicity, but we are a different lot out there. So, but to know how many more people we can invite into our community is good. It's good from a planning perspective. And I appreciate the constraints of the public service, but what I'm looking for is to get an idea for this area, how many more units. And if I'm hearing correctly, you're saying that, you know, it'll be a spitball, but you might be able to provide something. Is that what I'm hearing? Or you're saying that, no, this motion is invalid, and you encourage my colleagues to vote it down?
Let me try to maybe describe this a bit better. I think when we come back in June with our verbal update, I mean, that update is really related to biosolids capacity.
Mm-hmm.
So we're working with people.
Biosolids and not land drainage.
Not land drainage. Land drainage is a different issue. So I think, because when we look at servicing, there's water, there's sewer, there's drainage. Those are sort of the three elements of servicing that we look at. But I think what we can do, certainly in terms of what is the expected build out. I mean, I can't speak to the capacity in terms of what the future build out is. That's sort of the precinct plans. That's PP&D. The city is in a unique situation right now with capacity issues on biosolids. So I don't think we can answer your question specifically, but we can speak to it generally in the context of development all throughout the city. I think that's really what we can answer. If Councillor, if you're asking in Transcona West, can you tell me how many more homes can I build? I can't answer that question. Like, I cannot answer that question from a capacity perspective. We just don't, we don't have the resources. We don't look at it in that granular detail. Yeah.
For kind of a high level concept, like it will always be a snapshot, right? Like there's the, like what Maureen was saying, like, mm-hmm. like the physical capacity of a neighborhood, like the physical wastewater collection piping in a neighborhood, that's a snapshot. You know, hydraulically, it'll be sized for some initial plan, right? And there'll be regional infrastructure sized to bring this neighborhood's wastewater flow to closest plant. So initially there is a physical capacity designed to, with assumptions, but as the development
morphs,
as the development, you know, it's a race to use this capacity, right? And some of these assumptions, places get rezoned, maybe there's an industrial component that has a higher flow or this sort of thing. As it develops, that physical capacity may get used up. Mm-hmm. And that's to say nothing about the treatment capacity, right? Like this biosolids treatment thing, that's a totally different thing. And that's a citywide issue, right? So to be able to say, oh, there's a physical capacity for this many homes, you know, assuming it's homes, assuming this many people per home, there's single family, not multifamily, this sort of thing. In an area, there'll be a physical capacity, yes, but the snapshot, it's a snapshot. As soon as a different neighborhood gets developed, it'll use up some of that capacity. So whether it's North Transcona or South Transcona.
Hydro sending us a message, sorry.
Yeah. Yeah. Regardless of that, it's a snapshot. So as soon as that number would be developed, it would depend on what happens elsewhere in the city. And so that's what I think we're trying to say. It's a moving target.
Yeah. So I got, you know, it's one of those things. So, you know, hearing specific about water, land drainage, sewer, snapshot in time, is this maybe I misdirected this item. Maybe is this more appropriate to be with property and planning, or is property and planning able to inform us at this committee on the matter?
I think what property and development could advise is sort of what the build out is expected in that area based upon the precinct plans. They wouldn't be able to speak to the capacity, but they could tell you what the future projection would be for build out in that area. I think specifically, and you know, to Tim's point about the you know, what the development plans, they're executed over a number of years and in phases. So when you get to a certain point, maybe some of the infrastructure has to be expanded, because you don't take an area and overbuild the infrastructure for the area, because if you overbuild a water pipe, you're going to have issues with water quality, because you don't have the flow or the pressure. And on the wastewater side, you're going to have odor issues and pipe rot. So you build to when you think the demand is going to develop, and sometimes the demand exceeds that capacity and then you have to upgrade. So I think in terms of what is expected still in terms of development in those areas, that would be a PP&D. I don't think, I guess what I'll say, I don't know if I've ever said if I can, or if I've ever said no to a motion. I would say that I can't respond to that motion, but I can speak to generally some of the issues with specific servicing. But as always, like if there's an area that's wanting to be developed, I mean, I think the developer just needs to reach out to Water and Waste for us to provide that information, which is what we do all the time.
Yeah, I see Councillor Schreier and Councillor Orlico. I do 6 and 7 the same, whatever we're doing. And yeah, I would fear something like traffic studies, right? This would just be, you know, 20 of them a meeting start pouring in, and how do we do this? So, and the capacity that, you know, if we had a builder on Moore approved for 6 units and then has to come back a few years later and just told you're down to 3, because that's the room, nothing personal, that's you know, we treat everybody the same. It's not so there are fluctuations here, so none of that may be helpful, but I do think we have to treat 5, 6, and you don't want to be doing studies in your war, not at, you know, none to Nason, but yes, let's do one in
Sage Creek.
That's our concern, so okay, so I think Councillor Schreier and then Councillor Orlico.
I'm not certain that they should be treated exactly the same, and this is why. If you look at the one regarding Transcona West, it's regarding a rather large region of the ward. In my case, in the case of Councillor Brawadi's motions, it's one specific, very limited amount of one street. Mine is one street, 3 blocks, very different from Transcona West, and I'd like to give that some consideration. One is sort of macro, one is micro in that respect, and I don't see them the same. But having said that, I'm very sympathetic to Councillor Nason's wishes anyway to have a macro perspective on this, but mine is micro.
If I may counter to Councillor Schreier's, I could come back and say Ravelston and Altassi. I could name those 2 streets and have the exact same motion as the following 2. I used the Transcona West because there was an area structure planned for that entire area that is 20 some odd years old, if I recall correctly. But, you know, we've had rapid development in the area, and the site use plan, you know, the site use was based on single family homes. We've seen the suite of homes evolve because the want and desire are side by sides. So, you know, where they plan to put 1 house on a property, you know, it's now 2, which increases capacity. And if they have secondary suites, it's now 4. So that's where we end up in a situation where in these areas on this street of Ravenhurst, mid-block, 1414 Ravenhurst, we have a 72-unit multifamily that was built, right? It was changed, the zoning was allowed for it, and they could have had 120 units, but they went with 72, I think it was. But again, those all chew up the capacity in the area. So I know we're going around on this, but I see your point, Councillor Schreier.
I didn't realize that Transcona West was that small of an area, if you can say Ravelstone and another street.
That's where my true concern has been of late.
Maybe you might want to consider redefining
Your motion. I'll leave it at that. Just a suggestion.
I'd hope never to hear El Tassi again after that sidewalk hearing that we did, but.
Oh, don't even. See, I'm just about over that one. That Fiorentino. Don't forget Fiorentino.
The El Tassi family, yes. Trying hard to raise. But, Councillor Overlooker.
Oh, thank you very much. Councillor Nason is, quite correct that the issue of the ability to service sewer overland and to capture overland drainage are having an impact throughout the whole city. There's a couple of developments in the Rice Fork Gary Ward that have now been put on hold until the engineers figure out some solutions to address it. And that's with the combined sewer overflow area. So even that. So my questions right now to the administration and the issue like what Councillor Nason is talking about, I also recall an enormous amount of resources that were going there to provide extra water and sewer capacity. But does that make that area? I have no idea. I also heard from Maura and the director that we don't reserve capacity. Yeah, that's true. But I also have heard from developers that, you know what, we went through this whole rigmarole to get a rezoned property. We as councillors either were delightful or just got beaten on either way. And then all of a sudden they get to the point where their capacity issues hold back the amount of units they can develop, which makes the project not feasible. And that's a lot of process to get back to square one. So my question and I also heard was quite clear, and that's why I won't be supporting these motions, is that it's a very integrated approach. They have to be able to you have to look at the integration of how the water flows, what's flowing, where the pipes are. And so it's very micro to do these little reports, but I do support the idea of something, two things. The first one is providing developers an idea where, let's say we have red zones, yellow zones, green zones, where there are, potentially are some issues that we already know about. It could be in a combined sewer flow area that hasn't have those pipes developed yet. So that's legislative. So a higher level, at least start there. Because I do agree with you, then the second step would be for a developer goes, I want to go to that area in Transcona, but it's in a large area, it's in the red zone. So it may work, but before I do a huge application, I should go get that servicing checked out first. And in our development agreement processes, that should be also part of the requirements. So while I do understand where Councillor Nason is coming from, to get that information we've been told today is not possible without huge amounts of extra resources. I think even getting a general map is going to cost them more, and we'll probably have to, and I'll be more than happy to work with Councillor Nason for the next meeting to put a motion forward to look at something like that. But it's going to probably cost more money. Obviously it does, and we're going to have to try to figure out where we can source that money from so we all support the budget. Gotcha. But on that point, I don't understand where Council Mason is coming from and the development community. I was hoping to kind of see this in the development agreement parameters, maybe in the pre-application stage, we could settle all this, but it appears it's not happening at this point. So I'd like the administration to come back in the future, and I'll work on a motion with Councillor Nason. So this needs to be done up front before people put a lot of money and time through this process at time of. And if it can't be, I'd like to know why not. Because today we are told, if you have a developer who's interested in, Taylor Avenue, have them come and talk to us. Well, I thought that was already kind of should be happening during when it's circulated throughout the system before the PP&D comes forward. But it's not happening or something's happening. So by all means, I agree with the idea of a general overview. And I also agree that this should be done up front before the applications come forward to save everybody time and money if it's not possible. But at this point, I agree with the administration. The request, it says remaining sewer capacity, that's fraught with danger because we don't reserve it. So there's a number of issues there. So while I understand the intent of the motion from Councillor Nason, I won't be supporting him today.
Sorry, I still failed to hear if you will or won't.
Will not.
Will not. So, I think the intent of where I'm getting at, and I think I articulated it earlier, is that once we have plan approval, once plan approval comes before our community committees, that should be everybody's checked off and we're good. So if a development comes forward that has 15 units and it's gone through everybody's checklist and it comes to the community committee for plan approval, there's no unringing the bell. If we approve it for 15 units, that means it's got capacity for 15 units. What's happening though is that it's not. We are not approving 15 units because of some sober second thought, third thought. And maybe that's where we need to go back and have the offline dialogue to find some way to stop that from happening, because it is happening. So, you know, and that's where the 11th hour, 23rd hour concerns come in, because people are investing either publicly or privately, because sometimes this is private ownership, right? That are, you know, looking to develop their land or have bought a property they're living on. There's opportunity for subdivision, and we're kiboshing that. So yeah, like, you know, I understand Councilor Orlico, but I want to be clear on where I'm coming from.
Councilor Orlico.
You know, great points. I would just really be interested at this point, it's for a reply regarding this conversation we just had, and some feedback from the administration.
Happy to do so. I think I don't disagree with any comments about, you know, the capacity should be known early, very early on in the process. I agree with that. I think there's, you know what, and maybe, you know what, because it's not fun for us either when things get to a certain stage and then water and waste has to, you know, either say no or impose additional costs to the developer for things they have to do. One outstanding matter that we have right now is on this, the application of the CSO license to the combined sewer neighborhoods. We had council approve a policy late last year. We have not yet heard back from the province, who's our regulator. So we still, you know, we're hoping they agree with what council approved, but we don't know that yet. And I think the there's also a committee that I sit on with John Kiernan from PP&D, the Land Development Industry Advisory Group, with the Lanny McGinnis is there, and some of the development communities. So a lot of these issues we're discussing and looking at solutions and how we work better with that community. So I think, and I think one of the, you know, the mandatory pre-op process, there is a new planning person in PP&D, David Jopling. We've certainly had some discussions with PP&D, like, how do we improve the process? So, you know, it's not the, you know, and often it's not the 11th hour, but it's felt to be the 11th hour that all of a sudden there's a change in what we have to do to proceed. So I think maybe what the answer to the motion is, not to say specifically what the capacity is on this street or in this area, but what can the public service do to make sure that those wanting to develop find out early on what the limitations are in servicing, right? I think maybe that's the improvement that we're looking for. And I would suggest that maybe, you know what, we could come back to this committee in 60 days, but I would come with my friend John, and we could both speak to the planning process and how we can try to build that in earlier, because, you know, things, I don't think a pre-op has been mandatory for everything, but, you know, I think that's one of the things that that PP&D has been discussing, and I don't want to speak out of turn. I'm not that familiar, but I know there's certainly some conversation around that. And then there's another internal group at the city, the planning committee, that has the directors and our deputy CAO economist sit on that committee. So I think maybe John and I could jointly come back and speak to the committee how we could do better, so there is no surprises for developers. I don't know if that helps.
I think Captain Nation had a question coming to that.
Just one more little retort. Like, you know, we talked about early on in the process, mandatory pre-app, where my challenges and heartburn are coming from is after plan approval, right? To me, plan approvals just before they're getting ready to build, like before permits are issued, if I understand the process appropriately. And that's where the heartburn is, right? So they've made the financial commitment, they've optioned the property, they've done their planning, they've submitted their plans, everybody's had an opportunity to comment on it, from traffic, from sewer, from whatever, the planning department, you know, and then they're coming before us to be able to build in compliance with the city, and then they're being told, you can't build what you want, right? You have to scale it back. You have to change your plans. Sometimes radical. Sometimes, you know, I'm familiar with one that's on Springfield Road that was, you know, they had approval from plan approval, I believe it was for 15 units. And then came back and were told that they could only have 5. You know, it's, you know, from 15 to 5 is a pretty radical change. And I'm sure there's other examples around the city. So I'm prepared to withdraw this and then come back with something a little stronger, talk to my colleagues and try to figure out a way, because I think we all have interest. I know Councillor Schreier indicated his is slightly different and Councillor Berwati's is slightly different, but I think we come back with a better discussion or a better motion to achieve what we want in the end.
Good.
Yeah.
Yeah, and we do have two different challenges here. We have the overall, as I think Councillor Nace said, the 90,000 person units or what are they?
Mine is the small thing that's morphed into a larger
thing. Right. That's the bigger thing. And then there's the localized problem of, and I've used this example of just north of Bishop, east of St. Anne's, there's no room. Two houses wanted to come on, hard no. No, you can't hook up. Just north of Bishop, west of St. Anne's, we approved an apartment building within the past 6, 8, 10 months. So there was room on that side. So it's really, you know, which side of the street you're on, it can be very, it can vary basically within pretty small areas. So,
yeah.
All right. So we seem to have, that's a good discussion of,
I'd like
of to, an issue.
Yeah. If there's no other dialogue, I'd like to receive this as information.
All right. All those in favor of receiving it as information? All right. Thank you. That's carried. Number 6 then. That's the Berwati one.
Yes, item 6 is Councillor Berwati's
one. Receive that as information as well.
I'll move that.
Councillor Orlico moves. We receive that as information in light of the discussion and to come back with some further dialogue with the departments, trying to come up with a reporting scheme here. Okay, so
but I'd have to say, if I may, how do I know this isn't the more specific or conducive language, given it defines it very precisely?
Well, if I may, Councillor Schreier, since you are articulating that it is a very finite thing, I think this is something that you could possibly just simply email the department on and ask for their feedback on, because it is finite.
All right. Well, look, I mean, when it comes to mine, I mean, these were inspiring to me. It's really important.
They were inspired based on mine. You guys piggyback on. So
absolutely, Councillor Nathan. I'm not in any way, shape, or form denying that.
Yeah.
But I don't know what to say. I didn't ask you to withdraw your motion, Councillor Nason. But so be it. My suggestion to you is to reword it, given that a concern by Councillor Orlico, by the administration, was sort of the difficulty in dealing with the generality of it. Mine is not, nor is Councillor Berwati's, and there I see a distinction.
But if you heard the chair and his eloquent speech, which I actually understood his legal speech, he didn't want this to turn into the traffic study debacles that IRPW seemed to undertake, that everybody has a traffic study. Now, every ward councillor is going to be asking for street by street sewer capacity study.
I nonetheless do wish to speak when it comes to the next motion.
Yeah, fair enough.
I think there will be an end to this, given what we are dealing with here as a standing committee and as a community mm-hmm. committee on behalf of the city. But nonetheless.
Okay, so we have the motion from Councillor Urlico to receive number 6 as information. All those in favor?
Aye.
All right. Councillor Trier, you were it?
Nay.
Okay. And so noted. And that passes on to number 7. Noting that Talbot's been waiting for a secondary plan even longer than my one on the Seine River. I think Talbot dates to 2013, and the Seine River one that was moved by Vandal dates only to 14, but I'm sorting that out with the planners. But in any event, when I see Talbot, that's what I think of. Councillor Trier, you would probably want to speak to this one.
I do, yes. I moved it in the spirit of Councillor Nason and Councillor Berwati's motions. I was very specific and limiting in terms of the scope of the motion, the scope of the request upon the administration. And the reason, though, is large. It has ramifications for the entire city, where we're at right now in terms of this new newly created phase in the bureaucracy of development and development applications. Right at this point, I can tell you, I'm not the only one to say this, it's a form of disaster for people that have so far, because of what people have done. They've put in tens of thousands of dollars into their enterprise and into these proposals, only to find out afterwards after getting an okay from the city, only to find out that it's not okay. And then they have to go back to the drawing board. And I mean, this is disaster. I don't know. I couldn't afford to do something like that. I couldn't. I don't know what I would do if this happened to me. And this is truly unfortunate what has happened to development business in at least 3 wards, if not all, not others. So yes, it happens to be that is the East Kelowna Transcona Community Committee, the 3 councils, I guess, sort of initiated this. What the heck is going on because of what has happened to businesses here? We need, in this case, I mean, I'm talking about one street, 3 blocks, because since I was elected, density, infill, density, and that's where we're supposed to do it. Then on Talbot, because it's a major bus route, this is exactly where we're supposed to have the density, because this is the bus route. It's close, you know, to the Louise Bridge, to Watt Street that goes into, turns into Archibald, which goes into St. Boniface to St. Vital, or down Provence into the downtown, or it's on its way to the Disraeli. It really is. It's just a block away. Talbot sort of ends a block away from Hespeler, which is, you know, the Harry Lazarenko Bridge. And now I just allowed for the most densely building of suites at the corner of Talbot and Stadacona for the purposes of some form of halfway house run by Riverwood Church. But now others are doing what they're supposed to do, what I'm told I'm supposed to do, what we're all supposed to do on Talbot. And then they're saying, now that they're doing what they're supposed to do, putting their resources into doing what they're supposed to do, density on Talbot, then they're saying, well, no, now they've lost their money. And like, I feel accountable for this, at least on behalf of the city, to give an explanation of how this could be happening right that very region of Talbot, of all areas of Northeast Winnipeg. Of any area of Northeast Winnipeg, I'd say that area is the area where we owe the most for an explanation really right out soon. Because if you can't do that on Talbot in that area that I specified, what's going on for Northeast Winnipeg, let alone sort of the downtown and core area? Bear in mind, that area is being considered part of the core area of the city in the 80s during the Corey Erie Initiative. It included that area of Elmwood. And so remember, it's been part of the city since 1906. Elmwood broke away from the Kildonans in 1906 to get city services. It's part of that density. It's part of that. And now, all of a sudden, whoop, you lost $100,000 or whatever. Gone. Your money's gone. And I owe an explanation, and big time. In fact, a rigorous one, because this is the street. These are the blocks. I mean, no offense to the rest of North Kelowna or Transcona or the rest of my ward of Valley Gardens or what have you. But I mean, you know, if we can't explain what's going on here, we're in trouble for density in my quadrant of the city. So I just want some sort of rigorous explanation in terms of now and for the future reference, how it is that the mantra can't even apply to one street in Northeast Winnipeg, where it is the most, it's the great candidate. It's the poster child of density for, and I proved it last year. I did it like no other councillor before. Brought in the most densely suited, if you will, smallest suites for any building in the area, if not the city in recent decades. So I'm being sincere. I'm being consistent. But it's just that isn't enough for the people that lost their shirts in recent development applications. And what am I supposed to do? I think this is some sort of, I think this is sufficient, and I ask that we pass this one. Because I'm sorry, this isn't Transcona, this isn't North Kildonan. This is Elmwood, talking a block from the Louise Bridge. A block from where Watt meets up with Nairn, which becomes a block later south Archibald.
I mean, it's a very fair point. It's a fair question, and let's see what we can do about getting that answered. If not today, then I mean, it's a fair point. You're saying, here we are on a transit route. This is where we as councillors are told in planning terms, this is where we should densify. So I've taken the hit politically. I've gone ahead and done that, and then there's this banana peel in the way. There's this, something has happened here that we slip up and now the investors are told, no, there's no room in the pipe. So no, this isn't the place to go. That's a fair question. How to answer that today? I'll look over to the administration though and say, maybe we can't answer that today, but maybe we can answer it. And there's probably other examples, maybe none as strident or as strident or none as visible as that.
Strident was the format in which I expressed it, but nonetheless.
Fair. That's a fair comment. So, the Director Gear, what can we say about that? Like, can we ever predict this sort of thing? How do we come up with an answer to that question?
It's a good question. The answer is not easy or straightforward. I think what whether it's a street or an area, the work and the conversation is the same. I think what I've been hearing today with discussion, Mr. Chair, with your colleagues is about when in the process folks learn that there's a capacity issue, and it's more of a systemic issue with before developers start investing a lot of money, that they know what some of the limitations are, some of the costs, what they can, what they cannot do. And it sounded to me from Councillor Nason's with his item number 5 to receive it as information, but work towards having a more meaningful, thoughtful motion come forward at committee, how we could deal with this, to come back with a motion that really gets to the root of the issue. And I guess what I would suggest is, as the public service with the committee, and John might hit me, but I'll volunteer John as well, that we can work with the committee to come up with, like, really what is the policy advice and direction that you want from the public service, so we could work with you so that we can come back and provide some meaningful information. I think, Councillor Schreier, to your comment, if there's a very specific issue, with a specific application or a servicing report that was denied, then I would be happy to, you know, if you want to reach out to me and I could provide those specifics. It's, you know, it's a situation of, so I think we would receive that as information, because it's like, if I can say analogous to our customer billing, is we can talk generally about policy, but we will never talk specifically about one customer or one account. So if it's a very specific issue, I don't think it's appropriate that we discuss it at committee, because then there's some private information, there's FIPA, there's considerations. But I think systemically, we could work with this committee to help you with a motion so we can come back and get you the information you need. I think that's, to me, that's what I think would help with these discussions and help address these issues. So, I mean, that's my interpretation, and correct me if I'm wrong, but I think that may get you what you're looking for.
Thank you. Well, look, I mean, it looks like, you know, given just what happened in the last two motions, mine as it is won't pass, despite the fact that I think I made a real case of how the area I'm talking about is, you know, if we can't deal with this one in terms of the format of these motions, I think we're in trouble. We're talking about whether we're talking about something anecdotally specifically or systemically. I think any anecdotal or any specific issue on the street is a greater indication of a systemic issue that I want to know as I deal with the developers or as the developers deal with the city. And so I think I'm doing the administration a favor by doing this, and the developers a favor by doing this, everybody, the system, because the system kind of broke down here and we don't know why. And it's not just because of one application. Oh, well, they just didn't do the new process. Well, no, what's going on Talbot after the whole mantra of density, especially on Talbot, when it applies to all the Northeast Winnipeg, all of it, Talbot right there where I specifically stated, after I let in the most densely packed multi-dwelling building of 45 or so dwellings, and then we've got this. This is a systemic problem that's caused, very uncomfortable, if not financially disastrous, results. So I need, if you don't want to look at it as an individual issue, don't. Then look at it as a systemic analysis. Either way, it doesn't matter to me. I need to know what the heck's going on. Density, yep. But not even on Talbot. Okay. Well, let me know. Please let me know. So that's the reason for this, because I want Winnipeg to know, and I want my community to know. Look, I've taken the hits for density because I was told to. Because I was told that's what we have to do. Despite the fact that was our 25-year plan, density is going to be the solution to our carbon footprint. Meanwhile, it's not even close to what we can do regarding conversion of natural gas to hydro or electric cars in Winnipeg. Not Alberta or Berkeley, but in Winnipeg. And yet I'm doing my job as I'm told to. Yeah. So tell me what I'm doing wrong.
You've made that point, and that's why we did that motion. You made that point on council floor very eloquently, saying it isn't all just going to be packing in. Some of this is how we heat the buildings, and so it was good. That's
more of that.
Beat it, take action. So we're doing something. Councilor Nason had a comment.
Yeah, just, you know, again reiterating from a development perspective, a city building perspective, it's good to have this stuff. This is a very good dialogue to have. Is it, you know, I think that it serves this committee well to as was mentioned, to have Mr. Kiernan here to so we can have the dialogue of the two directors to understand from a perspective of Winnipeg and development, where we're at, where we're going. We have a competitive situation where outside the boundaries of the city of Winnipeg, it seems to be much easier to get stuff done. I see it at the edge of my ward of Transcona. So to have an understanding of where we're at, where we can go, where, you know, go up, go out, whatever it may be, to be able to have that dialogue here and understand our sewer capacity, be it, you know, our overland, be it our water, be it our sewer, I think when we come back as a group, I'll say a team, and it's a bit of a stretch, but we could be on the same team. I don't know who's going to control the play or the ball or be the quarterback. I guess Councillor Mays is the quarterback.
Always.
But to go to step away from this today and you know, come back, hopefully come back next month, because I think there is some urgency. There's some urgency. I know Plan 2050 is coming forward from the metro region. But from our perspective, our Winnipeg and everything else, to come back so that we can set the table for our communities to know as residents, here's where we're going and here's why. And I think this dialogue was good today for that purpose.
Okay.
Well, therefore, if I may ask Councillor Nathan, therefore you're saying about this motion, lay it over so we can have a better motion next month along with the Transco.
I'm okay with
I would, my preference, Councillor Schreier, would be to receive it as information. We go away and we can table as a team a stronger motion that achieves what I think we're all on the same page for one.
But if I may, that's okay with me in terms of the spirit of things. Bear in mind, I'll say this about my own ward, not just North Kildonan or Transcona. Valley Gardens or Hazeldell is not Talbot. And it's a very specific case for density. And if we can't deal with Talbot, then where are we? I don't need to know how Valley Gardens fits into density as I need Talbot. Because you see what's happening now, what I'll have to say, if we can't deal, like, we're doing an about face. Now it's an amazing day, because this is the day we're saying it's about conversion of hydro, from natural gas to hydro. And it's not about density. What's going to solve our, we can't do the density, we can do the hydro. I mean, so be it. I mean, facts are facts. It's true. Because what I'm amazed by is that our 25-year plan for our climate action plan was giving the impression that density is the solution. It's not. It's just a percentage. Hydro conversion is actually, or you know, away from fossil fuels is a real solution. I'm just confused. And if I'm confused, well, who else is? Okay. And therefore, I owe it to myself and therefore
everyone. I think Councillor Lukow has moved that we received this, noting your very
strong,
well-founded concerns about what's going on there on Talbot and the seeming contrary directions of densifying versus no, we got no room left. Noting that, though, but based on the larger discussion, Councillor Orlico moves to receive his information. So all those in favor?
Aye.
And Councillor Schreier, I assume you're opposed. Thank you.
But I do appreciate where you're coming from. I do, and I think we'll move forward from this.
Yeah.
But nonetheless, thanks.
I think Councillor Nason.
I'm seeking suspension of rules for an item of new business.
Councillor Nason.
I think that's the appropriate.
Yeah, moves to suspend the rules to consider an item of new business. All those in favor? We did have a lot of discussion about process at the last council, so we're all trying to work through this. So
the motion has been circulated to the members of the committee and the director, the public service represented here, and the clerk. So we have some environmentally sensitive areas, prairie reserves, forests, that are around many of our communities. And they're somewhat under attack, I'll use that term, but there is development, be it road construction or building development around them. And I'm not aware of the protections or process that are around them. So I'm looking simply for the public service to come back, and I asked for 90 days, and maybe the public service will comment on it. That's a reasonable time frame. About how to protect these environmentally sensitive areas when their development's going on around them. So that's the crux of the motion.
Well,
I might need to consult with.
Yeah, I think the
planning friends.
Yeah, and it's maybe another one of those motions that, I mean, it's not just water and waste. Mm-hmm. It would be water and waste. It would be
public more an works. Environment.
Yeah.
Position. Yeah, it's water and waste. Public works is PP&D because it would also be how you govern private construction. I mean, we do our own private construction. We do renewals. There's road construction. I'm sure the city has some standards or things that they include in contracts for private work that is done, but I don't know. And I don't know if 9 days is enough. Again, I think we'd have to reach out. Those policies may exist already. I don't know. Tim, are you familiar at all? Any standards we have of, I know we board Elm Trees and River Heights when we're doing some renewals. I know that. And I mean, that's sensitive, but in terms of if you were doing something in adjacent to the Assiniboine Forest or whatever, a different location, I can't answer that, but.
The standard construction specifications would have requirements. You know, you have to put silt fencing up if you're doing excavation near a drainage, that kind of thing. So there's like those mechanics of construction, but you know, yeah, like I said, like there's private construction as well. To buildings being built. I'm not sure what. There's environmental assessments done on larger developments. I don't know about smaller developments, but.
Like the bioreserve has been designated a protected naturalist area, so I don't know who puts that designation on.
Bioreserve to the city of Winnipeg asset either.
I just, because it's been the one where all the development's gone around it, and we touch it. Same with the prairie grass region there off Pleasants. So
maybe the city naturalist too. So we would have there's a few folks involved. So I would say. Could we ask for more than 90 days? Just because I have, to be honest, like I'm not exactly sure how many departments will be involved or who would even. We're one department that construction.
Would it be reasonable to lay the matter over for 30 days and then maybe come back and be better informed?
Just then sure. We might.
Yeah, maybe there's an answer to that already. Maybe the standards exist already, and we could.
Yeah. Sure.
So is that acceptable?
Yeah,
that's your motion.
Yeah.
So what?
To put the matter on record, but lay it over for 30 days.
Yeah, a notice of motion.
Notice of motion.
If you're asking the department to take action on something, it might be a good idea to direct that. So, like, if you're perhaps provide a verbal, you could certainly. I mean, it's not on the agenda. Like, it's been walked on, but
yeah.
What is
otherwise like, I go back to community committee and then do it.
I think
just laying it over is fine in this circumstance because it's not that we'll get back a update on what I mean. There may be standards already. It may all be
to inform.
Yes, naturalists may have something to say. I know. Yeah, we take some steps when they repaved St. Patel Park. Road did their tree protection efforts made. Okay, so Councillor Nason then moves to lay over till the next meeting.
Yep.
The motion, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All right.
Motion to adjourn.
Any further business, Madam Clerk? Okay, so Councillor Nason, thanks, moves motion to adjourn. All those in favor?
Aye.
Thank you, and well done. That's a lot of business taken care of, and done in what?
More to do.
Done by 5 after 1. Okay.
If I may say, not the last motion notwithstanding, thank you, my fellow councillors, on the issue of hydro conversion. Yeah. Very, very important. And I will.
Good. All right.
I may be a little late.
Thanks for your work on that, too.